The sticks are taped. The skates are laced. It's time for Arizona Wildcat Hockey.
Again, back to the point, pole shot gets blocked. Marquis, another chance, another block. Marquis just hacking over, and he scores!
Joining us live from the Timothy Gasson broadcast booth, here is your Wildcat Hockey media team.
Welcome back, Wildcat fans, to the Tucson Arena. Sebastian Janik joined by Garrett Kane in the booth for the final home game of the season for the U of A Wildcats, at least in terms of the ACHA. We will have one final game against the Coyotes alumni. But Garrett, how big would it be for this Wildcats team to sweep ASU final home weekend, senior weekend?
This would definitely be a very big step up or an accomplishment for the seniors here. We have quite a few, and it would definitely be a very good thing. They're going on to greener pastures, and it would definitely be something good to close this out.
And before this game, we will have our senior night ceremony honoring each graduating senior. Make sure you stick around for that. Special teams, really the key to last night's 1-0 victory. Wildcats perfect on the penalty kill, able to score on the power play. Hopefully get some more 5-on-5 offense tonight.
Yeah, definitely. We definitely need to stay out of the box tonight. That definitely paid off last night. And keep the shots up on the goalie, because he definitely stood on his head last night.
It's definitely a battle of the goalies last night. We will head out a little bit early just to get ready for senior night. Sebastian Janik with Garrett Kane. This is Wildcat Hockey.
Great moments are born great opportunity.
Marquis, another chance, another block, and he scores!
So welcome back, Wildcat fans, to the Tucson Arena. We are going to have a ceremony this evening to honor the graduating seniors before puck drop. For those of you joining us on the live feed, thank you for being here. Final home game of the season at the Tucson Arena for the U of A Wildcats, winning last night's tilt against ASU 1-0. And Garrett, wasn't exactly the cleanest game, but certainly the penalty kill is a great thing to look to, because ASU really only was dangerous on their power play.
Yeah, definitely. I didn't really get to watch much of the game because I was running the stream back in the back end, but I definitely noticed a consistency of staying out of the box is definitely the best way to win the game.
And definitely the best line for the Wildcats overall was the second line, Josh Lusby, Jackson Mace, and who was on that? And Tyler Myers, that was Sam Myers that was on that. No, Tyler Myers. Sam Myers, he's moved on from the Wildcats. So definitely good to see that line that's been put together, getting some chemistry, getting a little bit more ice time and practice together as a chance to build a little bit of that awareness of where they are on the ice. No, it is Sam Myers. My apologies again. A little bit of a hectic evening here, getting everything ready for senior night. But we'll get things going here on the broadcast.
Yeah, the lines were definitely jumbled up a little bit last night. It's going to be the same way tonight. Got a couple players out. Shetland's going to be out.
Yeah, so it's going to be Malco moving on to that top line with Selman and Lowell. And they are two players that have been able to pretty much complement anyone they play with. It'll be interesting to see how that goes. But definitely such an important night here for these seniors who are graduating to know they get one final win on home ice in front of the Tucson crowd. Great crowd here this evening. So we'll be very excited to get this one going. And ceremony will slow things down a tiny bit. But the players will be coming out on the ice relatively soon here. And it's always really nice to see the reception that the Tucson community gives to the seniors that they've watched over the years. And, you know, COVID, some canceled seasons made it so didn't get to know these players quite as well. But it's always great to see so many family and friends in attendance for what's a big moment in the career of these college hockey players moving on from, you know, that final part of that journey that's led all the way here. A couple guys looking to maybe go play in Europe, continue their hockey career after the U of A. But every guy you talk to seems to be very appreciative of their time here at Arizona, not only for the program, but the school as well and the city. And we always love to hear that from the players when they're heading out, just how much it meant to them. During the intermissions this game, during the broadcast, we will have interviews with each of the seniors to play, give you a little bit of a sense of how they're feeling coming into this final weekend.
Yeah, and I heard you say, referencing the attendance here, and they're definitely getting back to the numbers they were before COVID. We used to pack this stadium, and now it's coming back to life. This program has really taken flight in the past couple of years.
Yeah, and it's only upwards from here. The Wildcats probably going to be looking at their winning percentage on the season and not be as happy as they could be, but still have given themselves a chance to get to the national tournament. And as long as you can punch your ticket, you've got a chance. So this final tune-up game before the national tournament in Boston in March. So the Wildcats know this is a fun night. This is an exciting night. You want to enjoy these final moments of your college career in terms of playing here, but the national tournament's still coming up, and you got to keep a very detail-oriented focus against an ASU team that we saw last night. Very little, you know, generation of consistent offense, not much zone time, but quick strikes on the rush are really where ASU thrive. And if you're caught, you know, pinching a little bit too much, if you're caught too deep in the zone and get a guy like Brendan Studioso behind you, could end up in the back of your net. But Biv going back to back tonight as Nolan Bavolsik is playing his final games as a Wildcat. So as Chad Berman said, speaking with him earlier this week, it's Biv's net, and that's the way it's going to be from here on out. So the seniors for the Wildcats will come out first, and we'll go to the PA announcer, Joe Pirates. He'll give you all the information and just exactly who we're celebrating and what they've accomplished.
Here they come, the
So the team will come out, and then each individual senior will take their solo skate around the rink for a final time with their teammates in support. Some big names moving on from this program. Matthew Hole, Josh Lusby, Christopher Hedgecoat, Cameron Timor, Nolan Bavolsik.
I definitely saw that looking at each of the majors that the graduating seniors, they definitely aren't just hockey players. They are about academics also. So that tells you a lot about the program that we have here at the U of A.
And as I named off those five seniors, cannot forget the six, Duke Litwin. Been a pleasure to get to know him over the years. Hopefully his ego will survive, no longer having a camera on him all the time, but I think Duke will be just fine.
Wildcat fans, please direct your attention to the red carpet in the corner of the arena and join me in welcoming our first graduating senior,
who comes from Phoenix, Arizona, number 3, Chris Hedgecoat. Chris Hedgecoke, better known as Hedge to his teammates, will be graduating from the University of Arizona with a biochemical engineering degree and a 3.95 GPA. After graduating, Chris plans to attend the College of Dental Medicine at Midwestern University to obtain his Doctor of Dental Medicine in the spring of 2027. His favorite memory as a Wildcat was sweeping ASU at the last weekend of his freshman year to win his first Cactus Cup. He will miss the incredible people he has been able to meet and form relationships with up and down the program. Coach Berman had this to say about Hedgecoke. Hedge will go down as one of the greatest stories of our program. He came here as a walk-on player with nothing promised. At the very start of his career, he struggled to get into the lineup. During that time, he never complained or felt sorry for himself. Instead, he kept his head down. He had a positive attitude and worked hard every day. Eventually, due to his persistence, work ethic, and determination, he forced me to play him, and he was never taken out of the lineup ever again. I will forever refer to Hedge as an example of how to handle adversity the right way by focusing on what matters. To me, the best way to summarize Hedge, he does everything the right way on and off the ice. He is an easy person to root for, and I have no doubt that this will translate into his adult life. He will undoubtedly do anything he can to make sure his success continues. Chris will leave here with three Cactus Cups and one WCHL Conference Championship. And he is joined tonight by his loving and supportive parents, Cindy and Bob Hedgecoke. Next, all the way from South Bend, Indiana, number 9, Cam Timor. Cam Timor will be graduating with a degree in landscape architecture and a 3.0 GPA. Timor plans to use his degree to create and improve quality of cities and communities by making them more sustainable. His favorite memory as a Wildcat was winning the WCHL championship his freshman year, as well as all the things that seemed to be so challenging in the moment. The early morning bat practices, the bus rides to Chandler for practice, and the cancellation of nationals due to COVID. All the challenges we faced together, yet we found a way. I carry those memories with me forever, he says. He will miss everything that comes with it, competing alongside the guys and hearing the cheers from the best fans in the ACHA. Coach Berman had this to say about Timor. Cam is a special talent. His poise with the puck, hockey IQ, physicality, and quick release from the point are as good as a full package as anyone in the ACHA. There is no replacing a player of his ability. We will just have to do things differently. Beyond that, I will miss most the many memories off the ice. He will always enter the locker room with a giant smile, even at 6 a.m. I will definitely miss the countless college football conversations we have debating our hometown rival teams, Michigan and Notre Dame. Timor, the player, was very impressive, but I will miss the person the most. Cam Timor will leave here with three Cactus Cups, one CHL Conference Championship, as well as being named to the ACHL All-Conference Team, WCHL First Team All-Rookie, and we suspect there is much more accolades to come at the end of this year. Timor has played in 80 games, has 16 goals, 36 assists, and a total of 52 points. He is joined tonight by his parents, Darren and Yolanda Timor, as well as his sister, Ashley, and grandmother, Roz. Next up from beautiful Fenton, Missouri, number 13, Matthew Hull. Matt Hull will graduate with a degree in nutritional sciences with a 3.0 GPA. Moving forward, he plans to work with hockey players as a sports dietitian. Matthew's favorite memory as a Wildcat was winning the WCHL Conference Championship in back-to-back seasons. He will miss playing in front of the best fans in the ACHA, the banter in the locker room with the guys every day at practice, and getting to wear the Arizona A alongside his brothers. Coach Berman had this to say about Hull. It's been such a pleasure to have Hull both as a player and a person in our program. He came to us before aging out of juniors, so he was young and very talented. I will never forget the first practice that he was here. We were in desperate need of upgrading our defensive core at the time, and I could immediately tell that him and his partner, Ben Jones, would provide exactly that. At the moment, we knew we were on the new heights as a program. He brought a hockey IQ and a detailed, oriented process that we really needed. From there, he continued to grow and become a leader of the program and in some ways set the new standard of what is expected on and off the ice in our program. His impact will be felt beyond his time here at the University of Arizona. He will be greatly missed but not forgotten. Matt will leave here with 4 Cactus Cups, 2 WCHL Conference Championships, 2 ACHA Community Service Awards. He has played in 123 games, has 10 goals and 37 assists for a career total points of 47. Joining Matthew tonight is his parents, Tim and Teresa Hull. Next up, from Bemidji, Minnesota, number 23, Josh Lesby. Josh Lesby, better known as Luz to his teammates, will graduate with a degree in literacy, learning, and leadership with a 3.4 GPA. Moving forward, he plans to pursue a professional career in hockey before getting involved with teaching and coaching. His favorite memory as a Wildcat was playing at the TCC in front of the best fans in the ACHA. He will miss the family atmosphere in the locker room and pursuit of a common goal with his teammates. Coach Berman had this to say about Lesby. Luz will be a tough one to see leaving. We always had a great connection with baseball. I will miss the in-depth baseball conversations and analysts in the locker room, not to mention his size and athleticism. He was a college catcher before coming here, and if you saw him off-ice workouts, you would know exactly what I mean. Everything Luz does is done at 100%, much like Hedge. Everything he does is done the right way all the time. I couldn't possibly say enough great things about Josh Lesby. Although his time here was short, he will be greatly missed. On a final note to Luz, this is from Coach Berman, go Tigers! Lesby will leave here with 3 Cactus Cups and 1 WCHL Conference Championship. He is joined here tonight by his parents, Mark and Tracy, girlfriend Taylor, and the Radke family. Next up from Montreal, Canada, number 26, Duke Litwin. Duke Litwin will graduate with a degree in behavioral sciences as well as a minor in Judaic studies and sports management with a 3.0 GPA. He is currently interviewing for roles within sports management and entertainment companies. When asked about his favorite memories as a Wildcat, Duke said, "So many memories come to mind. Winning the WCHL Conference Championship my freshman year and never losing the Cactus Cup and scoring in front of my family and friends. Saturday night games versus ASU in front of a packed arena, the band playing here while you skate out on the ice. Nothing will beat my experience here at Arizona." He says he'll miss being part of the everyday culture that comes with being a Wildcat. "I truly believe no program in all of college hockey does it better than all of us here in Tucson. I've been blessed. Walking into the locker room every day and being able to banter with 30 of my brothers about life, sports, and school daily are the memories I will cherish for my entire life." Coach Berman had this to say about Litwin. "I imagine our locker room will be much quieter next season, especially in terms of hearing about the Montreal Canadiens or the Baltimore Ravens. We will greatly miss Duke and his bubbly personality. He always came to the rink with such an infectiously positive attitude towards life. It didn't matter if you're talking hockey, current events, or whatever. Duke was always passionately engaged. I wish more people were enthusiastic about life as Duke. His speed was always a tremendous weapon in the transition for us. Just like his mouth, his feet were always moving at a 100-mile-an-hour pace. He is the kind of teammate that is always looking to pull others into the conversation, include them, and make them feel welcome. We will greatly miss having Duke around." Duke will leave here with 3 Cactus Cups and 1 WCHL Conference Championship, Duke is joined by his parents tonight, Susie and Lori Litwin. And now last but not least, all the way from San Jose, California, number 35, Nolan Bibosek. Nolan Bibosek, better known to his teammates as Biv, will be in the be graduating with a degree in industrial engineering and a minor in mechanical engineering with a 3.4 GPA. Nolan plans to pursue a career in aerospace and defense industry with the hopes of one day working for SpaceX. We hope you make it to the moon, dude. His favorite memory as a Wildcat was seeing the program evolve. When I first came here as a freshman, hockey seemed to be second on everyone's list. Over the years, Coach Berman has created a standard with new recruits that hockey is a priority and that we are here to win. The culture that we have created is here is something that I hope continues for years to come. Nolan says he will miss everything that defines Wildcat hockey, from the early morning practices to stepping on the ice at the TCC against our rivals to the north. It is something truly unique that other programs will never get a chance to experience. This year especially, our team has been the closest team I've ever been a part of, and it's going to be hard to leave them. It is not sunk in that coming to the rink every day and seeing the guys will not be the norm anymore. I will always be proud to call myself a Wildcat, and thank you to everyone that has pushed and supported me along the way. Bear down.
So a great ceremony.
Coach Berman had this to say about Bibosek. Biv has been an absolute anchor in the net since the day he stepped on the campus. He is a really rare package of size and athleticism. He checks every box you could want in a goaltender, but he was more than that for us. He was a leader. He came in at a tough time, starting out as a third goalie, but he never stopped putting in the work. Now he will go down as one of the best goalies in the history of our program. Nolan Bibosek will leave here with 5 Cactus Cups, 2 WCHL Conference Championships, and 2 ACHA Community Service Awards. Bibosek has appeared in 60 games. He holds a goals against average of 2.62 and a save percentage of 90.7%. He is joined here on the ice by his girlfriend Megan, mom Ruth Ann, dad David, brother Miles, and aunt Delene. Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our senior night ceremony. Let's hear it one more time for your 2022 Arizona Wildcats senior class.
So probably should have waited for Joe Pirates to use the word conclude to come back in, but that will do it for the end of the senior ceremony. A couple big pieces of this program moving out, pieces that Coach Berman has multiple times described as just program-changing pieces. A guy like Matthew Hull that came in, a guy like Nolan Bibosek, changed everything for this program, and this will be their final game at the TCC.
Yeah, it's definitely heartbreaking to see him go, but they're definitely going on to a better place, getting into their careers, and definitely the lessons they've learned from being on this team is going to carry throughout their life.
Yeah, you definitely learn a lot about being a student and an athlete at the same time. Not difficult to do. You look at a guy like Christopher Hedgecock, that degree, that GPA while playing hockey, nothing simple about that. So your Wildcats are on the ice as we'll get ready for the starting lineups.
From Bemidji, Minnesota, number 23, Josh Lusby. And right wing, a senior from South Bend, Indiana, number 9, Cam Timor. At the center position for your Cats, all the way here from Montreal, Canada, Montreal Canadian fan, number 26, Duke Litwin. And left defense, a senior, and he's from Phoenix, Arizona, Hedge, number 3, Chris Hedgecock. And right defense from beautiful Fenton, Missouri, number 13, senior Matt Hall. And in the nets, as usual for your Wildcats, a senior all the way here from San Jose, California, number 35, Nolan Belosik. The head coach of your Wildcats is Chad Berman. Now, ladies and gentlemen, please rise for tonight's national anthem, which is sung by Annalise Mendoza.
Certainly an impressive performance here to start off the evening. Hopefully the Wildcats can follow that act up. A great attendance here this evening as the lights come up and you see just how many Wildcat faithful have come out to support UA hockey in the final home game of the season. It's Saturday night, it's ASU. As it's been said before, the ice is a canvas, and the Wildcats have a chance to paint a masterpiece on it tonight. Really, really want to finish out this season on a note. The seniors, emotional, excited, sad, disappointed, whatever it might be. But you got to think, and you know, the starting lineup a little bit funky tonight, a five-senior lineup. Maybe we get to see the rare appearance of Cameron Timor up on a top line, or Chad Berman might be throwing out.
Yeah,
we'll
this
see.
Is definitely not a lineup that you would usually see, but I definitely want to see what the impact is going to be on this first shift to get the game started.
Yeah, three defensemen, Lusby with Duke Litwin, so looks like a dad and a son. But up front, it's going to be interesting to see Timor doing what he does. So an exciting evening here. Cannot wait to get this game started. A 1-0 win last night felt a little uneventful in the grand scheme of things. But Studioso and Timor give themselves a little bump in the Wildcats. Lusby will get in on the forecheck. Litwin and Lusby, they're not able to control it though, and Plord will skate it out for ASU as the U of A chant start up here at the Tucson Arena. Lots of friends and family, and Cameron Timor gets absolutely leveled there by Ty Marchand. We'll see if he goes back out. Now Duke Litwin with a chance down the boards. Quick shot right into the chest there. Good rebound control by Garber, it's Roden's getting the start tonight. Definitely can tell as he stands up. The shoulders are well above the goalpost. Roden, a big goalie, not a lot of room up high. Got to try to get him moving side to side, but Roden gets the first save of the game. Timor takes the first hit of the game, and got to think Timor's the type of guy who takes a number, is going to be looking for Marchand later.
Yeah, definitely the best way to play against this goalie is to get him down on his knees and try to get him, pull him away from the goal.
So Jesse Lowell follows up with a big hit of their own for the Wildcats. So Jesse Lowell asserting his physical presence early here. Might not be one of the seniors, but he is certainly a tremendous leader for this Wildcats program as the captain. So now Matthew Hull, one of the other graduating seniors, breaks it out to Selman, skating on a line with Malco and Lowell. And that one pops out in front. Lowell just couldn't quite get to it first, but Roden with a misplay puts it almost on a tee for Jesse Lowell. So now the Wildcats keep everything to the outside. Quick out down the board. Selman, quick shot in there on Roden. Smart play there to not take the icing but get the line change. And Myers with a big hit along the boards. Now out in front for Mace. Mace takes a shot. Roden doesn't know where it is. He's laying down. It's behind him. It's still loose. And the ref waved that off before it passed over the goal line. And it's going to get scrappy here as Cooch for ASU is tugging on Jackson Mace. So even though the Wildcat crowd is going to be very excited here, you got to look. The ref was definitely yelling that one is not going to count. But there will be a couple disciplinary actions coming out of that scrum, but Myers creating that chance with a heavy forecheck.
Yeah, there's definitely going to be flames going this whole game here. The stakes, even though the stakes aren't that high, it's going to be the last game against ASU for this season.
And for, you know, the graduating seniors, their final game ever against ASU, so maybe the pressure of winning the Cactus Cup isn't there, but the pressure to not have a good night is certainly there, and these guys want to go out on a high note, have something to celebrate this weekend. So the Wildcats with a good offensive push early. No goal, as the Tucson faithful will not react to that well. But hopefully the Wildcats can remedy that call. Only a minute 30 gone in this first period, and Wildcats have been able to test Roden, and things have gotten a little scrappy, so we'll get some 4-on-4 hockey here. Lusby cannot win the faceoff from Plord. And Marchant, he'll try to get it out, maybe kept in, and they do. So Studioso gets it across ice. Plord, he tries to open up a little space, can't do it.
And this ASU line is definitely showing how they can spread the ice. This is their top lineup for ASU.
So using their top four guys, Marchant, Howsworth, Plord, and Studioso. So that one's behind Studioso, though, but Marchant's able to skate onto it, and it's offside as the Wildcats will get a faceoff outside of the ASU zone.
I'm not really sure if it's just my excitement or this game definitely seems a lot faster than last night.
Well,
playing with a lot more heart.
You know, we're 2 minutes in, and there's been two bigger hits already than we saw all of last night. Coach Berman, speaking with him pregame.
Number 29, Ian Erdman. 2 minutes for roughing. Wildcat penalty on number 4, Jackson Mays. 2 minutes for roughing. Both penalties at 1 minute 27 seconds of the first period.
So that's more like a U of A ASU game matching roughing penalties, but Connor Ziegler will swing it around the net, go back to the point. No, he waits, holds, tries to get the shot through, can't get it. Quick shot there, high, and Roden gets it with the glove.
We're going to have one more minute here with the 4-on-4 play.
So Ziegler, kind of interesting there. Usually that play is always back to the point, but he decides with that little bit of extra open ice, 4-on-4 to cut to the middle, sticks with the first fan shot, gets one off. And testing Roden early and often is going to definitely be critical to the Wildcats because he takes up a lot of that net. And the more you can force him to get moving and tire him out, it's going to give you much better chances. And Josephson, great job on the forecheck to get it back to Timor. Now he goes back to Josephson. Josephson, quick shot, doesn't get through. Ziegler scores! And Connor Ziegler on the second rebound opportunity. What a great job there by Josephson. Get that puck to the net. Timor in support, and the Wildcats strike early.
Amazing goal there. Right five hole. Couldn't get better than that.
Just
that's definitely going to get him in the head there with the first goal going in on a five hole.
And just a great job by Josephson. He recognizes 4-on-4. He's going to be able to take that middle too. Gets knocked down. Ziegler right into his feet. Quick release, shot, score. And Connor Ziegler gets the Wildcats on the board. And this Wildcat crowd gets to celebrate one that will end up on the scoreboard. So an early lead here for the Wildcats. Less than 3 minutes in. Definitely the buzz and jump we were hoping to see out of this team, knowing what it means to those other guys in the locker room who are playing their last game. And Chris Hedgecoke is one of those guys, and he goes down the board against Palmer. He's able to stick with it. Great job by Hedgecoke.
The number 22, Connor Ziegler! The assist goes to number 11, Will Josephson, and number 9, Cam Timor.
And a chance there almost out in front for Matthew Hole is this 4-on-4. You can see the Wildcats playing with a lot of confidence right now. Getting that first goal takes so much pressure off of the situation, and playing with a lead is something this Wildcat team needs to get comfortable doing if they're going to be able to win a national championship at some point. And Jackson Mace is going to head straight back into the box. He played the puck before he fully exited the box, I think. But they're going to get him for an interference call. So Jackson Mace makes it about a millisecond out of the box, and then he's put right back into it. So now ASU is going to be going on the power play as all this momentum that shifted to the Wildcats from that first goal. Now ASU's got a chance to strike back.
Yeah, that's definitely a penalty you don't see every day, getting an interference straight out of the box and going right back in.
So hopefully Mace is going to have some very fresh legs for the remainder of this period once he does exit the box. And he was definitely one of the Wildcats' more effective players last night playing with Myers and Lusby. So Wildcats here are going to have to kill one off early just as everything seemed to be going their way. And it'll be Selman and Lowell deployed to kill off the beginning of this penalty with Fisher and Cosden. So Selman in to take the faceoff. Able to win that draw. A place the Wildcats have been a little bit lacking in at times, but a great faceoff win. Quick clear past Marchand. And he'll look to set it up behind the ASU net. Outlets to Studioso. Studioso tries to go down the boards. Nothing going as Ryan Fisher gets in there first. Marchand able to open up some space back to Lackey. Now Marchand tries to swivel around the guarding Selman.
U of A is doing a great job of keeping those players out wide. They're not really closing in that much on the power play.
And they're definitely, you know, obviously on any power play, you're looking for those cross seam backdoor passes, but Wildcats doing a good job keeping active sticks and lanes, making nothing easy for the ASU power play, and 30 seconds gone on this one as that faceoff win was definitely a big part of that. The best defensive teams are always good in the dot. Now Josephson will get a chance to try to win this one, and he's able to as well. Hole can't get enough on it to get it out, and Marchand will hold it at the point with Studioso on one side, Lackey on the other. Now Studioso goes to Marchand. Back to Studioso. Over to Tillman. He loses it for a second. Back to Marchand. Back to Studioso. Great block there. Matthew Hole lays the body out, blocks the most talented goal scorer for ASU in Studioso, who is another one of those graduating seniors for ASU. They're going to have a number of guys going off, and they're playing in their final game too. And they know they want to try to get one back on U of A ice, but ASU cycling it well. Quick shot from the point and from the slot, and they score.
Yeah, that shot went right over Nolan Bavolsik's blocker over his shoulder. That was a really good shot there by ASU.
So some great cycling around the zone by ASU, and just as I go to talk about Brendan Studioso, he buries that one over the shoulder of Bavolsik. And nice. What really saved the Wildcats last night was being perfect on the penalty kill. And unfortunately tonight, that streak is going to get snapped early with 15:15 left to go in the first. So momentum, I'd say, right back to even right now.
Yeah, and I think Mace definitely learned his lesson not to touch the puck right after you're still in the box there.
Yeah, that was a strange call, but Wildcats will have to fight through a little bit of adversity tonight. And a big reverse hit there by Myers. Great job by Myers to realize the check has come and stand up and absolutely plant Brady Franklin. So now Shively, he'll dump it in deep. Roden will glove that one, and the U of A will get an offensive zone faceoff. So ASU, Brendan Studioso, he's done a lot of scoring on this ice over the years. You got to think he relishes giving it to the U of A crowd. So both teams now back to even 1-1.
Yeah, so pretty much a clean slate here. It's back down to 0-0, as I like to think about it.
Well, for the less, you know, about 5 minutes into this period, we've seen mostly 4-on-4 and penalty kill. So that 5-on-5 play that the Wildcats really dominated last night, they'll finally get back to that. So Shively Tries to go back to Lusby, but it's broken up there by Tillman. Shively and Timor will coordinate things in the back end as Lackey tries to get Shively, but catches an edge and goes down. Now the Wildcats maybe with a chance down the wing. They try to go middle, too many legs in the way, and now Clayton Lackey. Or that was Kylie Ram, my apologies. Now it's Lackey down the boards. Quick shot there, and Biv had to be alert to that one, able to stand up, take away the space, and get it up into the net. So that speed of Clayton Lackey down the wing.
Yeah, and the Wildcats are definitely excelling right now with their defense, making sure those shots are going as wide as possible in our zone.
Keeping ASU to the outside is key. We saw Studioso get right into the slot and bury one. They're more than capable of doing that. So Phillips will take the face off against Litwin. Litwin not able to win that one. Kruk with a quick shot and almost a deflection out in front by Schultz. So ASU with a little pep in their step after scoring that goal in terms of a response. Now Schultz trying to win a puck battle, but Litwin gets there first over to Fisher. Gets it through the middle. Walker's not able to knock that one down. And Palmer will ring it around. But ASU not able to get out of the zone. Big shot there from Fisher, and Roden has to fight that off with the pad, but a big rebound comes out to the point. And now Walker with it. He's able to get into some space. Walker waiting. Gets it over to Fisher. Fisher, quick shot. Roden with another pad save. Now Selman has it. Wildcats looking to generate something sustained here. Fisher down below the dot. Goes back to the point. Quick shot there. Roden fights that one off, but a big rebound out in front as Selman was crashing the net. Him and Kruk will get into it a little bit.
Yeah, Roden's doing a great job tonight of keeping control of those rebounds. That was kind of a tricky one there. It bounced off his pad, but he somehow managed to cover that with his glove and stop the play.
And you see how the size of Roden is, you know, probably going to kind of impact where the Wildcats want to put pucks on net. That's multiple shots there onto the pads trying to create rebounds, because when you get a goalie that tall, it's pretty hard to beat him over the shoulder unless you really get him moving. So the Wildcats are going to need some dynamic offense tonight, as they were only able to put up one last night in what was a good battle of dueling goalies. But
and it's definitely a little difficult to screen a goalie of that size. You can see right over your head.
Yeah, Roden, very, very tall, very, very capable. The Wildcats are going to have to find a way to beat him at least one more time. So that Jesse Lowell with a big hit there. That gets a draw from the crowd. And Jesse Lowell with it now over the line. He goes around to check. Lowell in shot. Roden has to fight that off with the blocker. And now Hole. He takes a quick shot. Roden able to fight through the screen of Brody Selman. But the Wildcats not turning down an opportunity to shoot.
And it looks like Roden caught that in between his arm there. And he was holding it with his jersey.
So Roden listed as 6'5 on the sheet on skates, closer to 6'7. That makes it pretty tough to get it over him, but that shot there from Jesse Lowell almost beat him blocker side. So Selman can't win the faceoff from Plord, and Marchant and Howsworth will try to break it out. ASU really relied on dump and chase hockey last night. We'll see if they're a little bit more confident with their breakouts through the neutral zone, a little bit more passing than just dumping it in. But it all depends what the Wildcats are able to effectively shut down.
Yeah, shutting down in the neutral zone, stopping those cross-ice passes is really going to change the flow of ASU and what they're going to, their playing style is through the neutral zone to get into the Wildcats' territory.
And the forecheck is going to be so important for the Wildcats tonight. Having that F1 support, that next guy in right there, Malco, is able to help support Selman. Marchant gets it, tries to get it around to Studioso, not a lot on it. Lowell tries to fish it back around the net, but it'll come out to Matthew Hole in the neutral zone.
Yeah, Matthew Hole's always been a player that's been really, really patient with the puck, and he makes very good decisions.
A very cerebral player, you know, always see that out of smart defensemen. Usually the good stick goes along with a high IQ as ASU dumps this in here. Plord's going to try to get to it first. Shively can't handle it.
Great job there by the Wildcats, doing that two-on-one, making sure that they get possession of the puck.
And a turnover there in the U of A zone. And they throw that one through the slot. Quick shot there, and Biv kind of has to fight through the screen of Maze to get that one.
Yeah, Lusby did a great job of pressuring that shot, so it wasn't 100% where that defenseman wanted it to go.
So 11:59 left to go here in the first period. Jackson Mace will be in to take the faceoff against Kylie Ram. Establishing possession in the dots, something the Wildcats need to improve on. Mace able to win that one with a little bit of support, and the Wildcats get it back out to center ice. And a turnover there for Myers, just can't drag it around his man. But now Mace down the wing. Good power move, tries to go middle, just can't do it. Still has possession, Tillman on him. Now it's going to be Myers. He's trying to hold on to that puck and get something ringed around the boards, but he's all tied up there in the corner. Lusby comes in, and a puck battle that Mace can't win there. And now over the line, ASU will take the dump, and it's going to be a penalty here coming against ASU, I believe. An interference behind the play, and then Jackson Mace goes through Connor Tillman.
I don't know if that was a very smart play there after that whistle was blown, getting already being awarded that power play there. You don't want to be going 4-on-4.
So it looks like Jackson Mace will not be heading to the box. It'll be Clayton Lackey, another one of the more infamous ASU players who have come into this building over the years. He'll head to the box, and now the Wildcats get a chance to respond on the power play. Single goal last night coming from Myers on the power play.
Yeah, Lackey is definitely somebody to not be taken lightly. He's a very good player.
Now Cameron Timor. Mace over to Myers. Selman goes middle, goes back to Myers. Myers down in the corner trying to get it back to the point. Timor is going to try to get there first, able to.
As you can see here, the Wildcats are kind of playing a lower game here.
So back to the point. Timor, quick shot, just goes wide on Roden with multiple guys out in front. And that escapes the forecheck of the Wildcats. And Timor will dump it over to Myers. Nice little touch pass there as Mace is able to get onto that one. So Mace back to Timor. Malco fresh off the bench. They go down low to Lowell. Lowell comes out in front, tries to jam it, can't get it. Roden's down. See how quickly he can recover. He's back up in the goal. Now Timor, quick shot. That one gets blocked down, and another rebound out in front. The Wildcats just couldn't get to first, but a lot of pressure here. Big slap shot there. And Jackson Mays with another big hit there. Wildcats able to keep possession again. Jesse Lowell back to the point to Timor.
The physicality is really proving a positive for the Wildcats right now.
They want to enjoy this one, and taking out a bit of aggression on ASU never hurts. Malco can't get that through the diving Kruk. Wildcats, though, spending this entire power play in the ASU zone, basically, but now it'll come out with only 30 seconds left to go. So some good sustained pressure and some good opportunities.
The Volsik went way out of the net there to maintain the puck possession for the Wildcats.
Biv always looks so calm and collected, like he's not really paying attention, but you know there's a million things running through his mind a minute.
Yeah, the goalies are definitely the quarterback of the team. Really get to see the entire ice and how each team is positioned.
So now Malco over to Walker. He gets it to Fisher. Fisher back to Malco. He takes a quick shot looking for tip out in front. That one just got tipped into the corner as Josephson was down low. He tries to do the turnaround shot. Can't get it. Back to 5-on-5 now as Josephson controls along the boards. Tries to switch out there with Walker. Malco through the legs pass, but Lusby, ooh, almost went the other way there.
Great recovery there by Lusby.
Oh, and Dylan Walker's down. He's going to struggle to get to the bench as Roden holds on to this one.
Yeah, it looks like Walker hurt his leg there. He's going to be checked out by the trainer.
So Walker takes a little bit of leg on leg there, goes down in a heap.
Looks like we're going to have a little bit of a conversation there back behind the net.
Well, Roden's definitely been a fan of laying on the belly to cover up rebounds, and his Wildcats come through the slot. Been a little contact here and there, and obviously in hockey, rule number one, can't touch the goalie. But this one will stay in the ASU zone. We'll see if Walker ends up staying on the bench or hopefully does not make that trip down the tunnel. So Litwin in to take the faceoff against Kylie Ram. Ref doesn't like the way that one was dropped, and we'll do it again. So a 1-1 game here. with goals coming from Connor Ziegler for U of A and Brendan Studioso for ASU.
Yeah, the wingers definitely on every faceoff are pushing the limits of having a replay on the faceoff.
Quick shot there from Hole. That one just doesn't quite make it through. Now ASU will look to break it out. The captain, Clayton Lackey, over to Kylie Ram. Kylie Ram gets around. Hole goes down to take away the slot. That one almost comes right out in front. But luckily that gets past the point man as Franklin was down there low. Marquis gets in, causes some problems. Unfortunately, the swooping Litwin couldn't pick that puck up. Nice little move there, though, by Stu Lerman to hold on to that puck. Now Matthew Hole, serpentine move, gets it over to Josephson. Josephson in. He goes down to a knee, can't control it. Puck still behind the net. Cosden trying to keep it in the zone. He's able to there, but it goes straight to Kylie Ram as he knocks that out, and Tillman gets onto it first. Now Tillman with a lot of room. Great save by Bavolsik. Now a turnaround shot from Lackey, and Bavolsik has to be sharp yet again.
With us tonight, welcome back, former captain number 15, Anthony Cusanelli.
So former captain Anthony Cusanelli getting a little bit of honors here on senior night. Definitely one of the more prolific names in this program with what he accomplished, so good to have him in the building as always. So now Jesse Lowell, he'll knock it past Kruk. ASU, they're able to generate a lot of speed on this breakout. Over the line is Plord. He's watched by Timor. Quick little backhand goes high of the glove of Bavolsik. And now Shively. Timor in his skates, but some good play there by Malco to tie up the stick. Selman tries to get around his man. He goes down a little bit awkwardly. So a couple little hip check trip kind of moves there that the U of A has taken, and hopefully those guys are no worse for wear as Kruk tries to beat out Mays. Kruk went down, and Mays went to go finish the hit. Luckily, nothing ends up poorly there for either guy. Jackson Mays definitely throwing around his body tonight. Hopefully that stays legal, though. Don't want to see U of A in the box too much as Plord. He'll wrap it around, and it'll be Hodgson drawn into his first game in a little bit here. Behind the net, they get out in front. A big shot there. ASU player crashes into Bavolsik. And it'll be an icing here, but number 44 for ASU goes straight into Bavolsik. And last night we saw Jesse Lowell get called for a goalie interference call.
Looks like they're gonna get a little chippy there. Good thing Nolan Bavolsik put up his hand there with Hodgson and told him that he was okay. Didn't need to interfere. Get a penalty, draw a penalty right there.
Yeah, so good job to see Biv. No worse for wear after that collision. And we'll stay 5-on-5 here as the draw will come back into the U of A offensive zone. Phillips in to take the faceoff for ASU. 6:44 left to go in the first period, all tied up at one here at the Tucson Arena on a Saturday night. Now Hodgson, he'll wrap it around the boards. Lesby gets there first, gets it out middle to Myers. Myers can't quite get it through into the zone. Back the other way, quick shot, Bavolsik save, rebound, tries to knock it out. And almost a follow-up opportunity there. Now a big battle out in front. Looks like a penalty is certainly coming out of this one. Multiple guys tied up in the crease. Fisher going at it with Phillips. This is ASU U of A. So they're gonna keep jarring at each other, keep going up high a little bit, and we'll see what the refs call out of this one. Not sure who started the chaos down in the crease.
There's definitely gonna be players going to the box here and serving some penalties.
The sin bin's gonna have a few occupants after this one, gotta think, but it'll be Matt. Yep, so it looks like it's gonna be Hodgson for the U of A going to the box along with Schultz for ASU.
And Hodgson already had a short fuse there from the play earlier, running into the goalie, so he was getting tired of ASU.
Coming in too far to the crease to Bavolsik, and it looks like we're going to go back to 4-on-4 yet again here. So the Pims are starting to rack up here early in the first period. 6:25 left to go. We'll We'll see how this all shakes out when the calls are finished.
And looks like Noah Vance is also going to be serving a penalty.
So that's Jackson Mays.
Or Jackson Mays, sorry.
Yeah, Jackson Mays going to the box as well. So the question is ASU going to end up on a power play? Ref's looking like he's signaling for another ASU player to come over, maybe to the box. So a discussion between the ref and the two captains here as they sort out exactly what the penalties will be. Definitely from looking at that scrum, you would think it would come away evened up. So everyone seemed to be going at everybody, but if this draw comes back into the U of A zone, I think it could be an ASU power play here. So 2 minutes up on the board for Mace.
And it's definitely not a bad thing that the head ref is calling these penalties. He's trying to keep the players safe here tonight. It's senior night. You don't want to get any of the seniors on both sides hurt.
The refs definitely want to, you know, draw that line in the sand of just how far they're going to let them go.
Yeah, and this is a game of hockey. It's not UFC, so.
So it is going to be an ASU power play out of this. Selman will have to win the faceoff against Studioso. So a big penalty kill here for the Wildcats. It's Hedgecoke.
Number 20, Tanner Schultz, 2 minutes for roughing. Wildcat penalty on number 10, Hunter Hodgson, 2 minutes for roughing. Wildcat penalty on number 4, Jackson Mays, 2 minutes for cross-checking. All penalties at 13:35 of the first period.
So it was cross-checking for Mays. So he is probably going to the box a little bit more than Chad Berman would like this evening so far. It is his first game, his first season as a Wildcat. He's getting acclimated to just how hostile this ASU U of A games can be. And now Clayton Lackey will look to wind it up. He goes to cut middle, can't get there, but it's picked up well there by Palmer. Back to Studioso. Studioso back at the point. Studioso fans, actually, I think it was a slap pass down to Lackey, almost connects perfectly. And now Tillman over to Marchant. Marchant waits, good block there. The Wildcats getting in shooting lanes, 47 seconds left to go shorthanded. Cosden will win that. Just barely gets enough on it to get it out of the zone as it was tipped by an ASU player.
Yeah, and Marchant is having a very good night here. He's definitely showing that he's a star player on the defensive end. Really keeping the possession of the puck for their power plays.
He's very confident with his shot as well, so a threat in that sense. Almost a steal there from Jesse Lowell as Howsworth got a little too relaxed in his own zone. 18 seconds left to go, and this is how you want to kill a penalty. You don't even let him out of the zone. So now Marchand, he can't get that pass through Jesse Lowell either.
And Jesse, definitely want to be careful there because you have two guys back, as you can see. It's a 3-on-2.
But a drop pass there, no one home except Jesse Lowell. He tries to get past Howsworth, can't do it. Now Mace out of the box. He holds in the zone. So now Shively will go back to Hole in his own zone. Hole off the board, Mace goes right through his man. And Shively comes in support to hold that puck. Taken away, though, by Palmer, but gives it away right back to the U of A. Myers tries to drag around his man, can't do it. Now Lusby, quick turnaround move, another one trying to hold that puck in against Howsworth. Myers down low, little spin move there, trying to get away from Ram, and he does. Opens up, goes to the slot, quick shot there, and Roden has to be aware on the blocker.
Yeah, Myers has been doing a great job on the boards, keeping the ASU on their toes and making really fancy plays, and they're definitely working out here.
So Myers with the hands and Mace with the body so far has been the story for this line. Myers back to Timor, tries to get it into the slot, does. Lusby, quick shot. Roden fights that one off with the blocker. Some tired ASU players out there, though. Some of these guys were on that power play that the Wildcats just killed off, and this line has done a great job hemming them in. Mace goes down, sticks in the feet. The Wildcats, Cosden just can't hold it in. ASU will go for a much-needed change there. 2:55 left to go in the first period, all tied up at one. Connor Ziegler with the goal for U of A. Now Cosden sweeps that one in, tries to go in on the one-man forecheck against Tillman. Cosden finishing his check. Now back to the point, Timor. Timor, quick shot, tip, and they score! It's Will Josephson on the back door, and the Wildcats retake the lead. Almost looked like a double deflection there, but Will Josephson, who has been more than deserving of some of these goals over the course of the season, scores in one of the biggest moments and blows the roof off the TCC after some trepidation when ASU tied it up.
Yeah, this is definitely a big goal there, Will Josephson.
So Timor looks like he's going to factor in on this goal again. And it was Cosden who swept that puck all the way in, stayed on the forecheck, got some support back to the point.
Goal! Give it to number 11, Will Josephson! The assist goes to number 2, Jacob Cosden, and number 9, Cam Timor. That's Josephson from Cosden and Timor. Time of your Wildcat goal, 17 minutes, 24 seconds in the first period.
So Timor already on a two-point night, adding to that great career that he's had here at the U of A. But Volsik with a little bit of a chance here and some chaos out in front of the net as that one comes through the slot. Marchant knocked it down. A Wildcat player, Duke Litwin, went hard into the boards, but he's just fine. So Marquis able to muscle it as far as the red line. And Dylan Walker back out there. Looks like he's skating just fine, so that's good to see. Minute 40 left to go in the first period. Will Josephson with a huge goal to give the Wildcats a lead in this first period.
And the intensity is just the same as it was in the first shift out here in the first start of the game.
These two teams have known each other for a while. As Coach Berman always says, we don't like them, they don't like us, and that's the way we like it in this game. In terms of the penalties, and that's going to be an offside there, unfortunately. Malco probably thought he had a lot of opportunity there, but the refs say no to the offside.
Yeah, that's definitely a little unfortunate. Seeing it open, just you and the goalie there staring down, and you get it called offsides.
And you could see the emotion from Will Josephson after scoring that goal. He's had a good season, just has not gotten the points that maybe the effort has come from. Battle here with Lowell in against Tillman.
Yeah, and Lowell's definitely showing his strength there in size.
But it's going to be ASU who's able to come out with it. They try to get it to Lackey, but Cooch just can't connect with him. Now Hole over to Hedgecoke. Hedgecoke tries to go to Lowell, but it's red, taken away by Cooch. Good stick from Lowell, doesn't let Tillman get it. But ASU still trying to cycle us the one around with 43 seconds left to go. Wildcats collapsing down low, giving Crux some room at the point. Quick shot there, tip, and Bavolsik, I think, got a piece of that one with the glove. Hedgecoke will ride Lackey into the boards. 32 seconds left to go in the period. Selman, great stick battle there to stick with it. And Brody Selman, what an effort there. And he'll get rewarded with applause from the Wildcat faithful as he's able to get that out of the zone all on his own. 16 seconds left to go.
And the Wildcats are on fire this period.
Definitely looking like the type of effort that the seniors deserve, that this Wildcat fan base deserves. As Coach Berman says, our first job is to beat ASU when Tucson shows up to support us. And right now, the U of A is doing just that. So 2-1 after the first period. Goals coming from Josephson and Ziegler, two hardworking guys who haven't scored a lot this season, but getting it done this Saturday night. The lone goal from ASU coming from Brendan Studioso. So overall, a pretty good period for the Wildcats. Unfortunately, they do give up that power play goal, but in terms of 5-on-5, much more dominant performance than ASU has been.
Yeah, I definitely agree. The intensity on both sides has been up this whole period. Usually you see it start to die off towards the end of the period. Legs kind of get tired. You need that break to get back to 100%, but they've been going every single shift.
And in that period, saw some roughing, saw some cross checks. Definitely want to see the good physical side of the game, but to beat this ASU team, you really want to stay out of the box. We'll be back in just a little bit to bring you the second period. Stick around during the intermission as we've got some interviews with the seniors to get their thoughts on moving on as Wildcats. Sebastian Janik with Garrett Kane. This is Wildcat Hockey.
I think coming to the University of Arizona, like a lot of people, I came from Chicago, Illinois. A lot of people in Chicago, the Midwest, don't know what kind of hockey they really have out here. So a lot of guys weren't aware that University of Arizona plays in front of 5,000 fans a night at the Tucson Convention Center. So I was out here from 89 to 93, and I think it was pretty much the last 2 years I was here, we averaged around probably 6,000 fans a game or something. So this place used to rock.
Special environment, special group. It's just, it's no place like family, like home, like this. It's just, it's different. Like, it's not coming to work, coming to play hockey. It's coming to be with my family, and it's awesome. Couldn't recommend it anymore.
Playing here was incredibly special, and there's nothing like it in the country. We have this incredible, you know, rink that we play in, and then. We truly are a family. I mean, this goes, you're gonna be an alumni a lot longer than you are a player.
Certainly the best thing is the camaraderie I have. The guys that we had a tight-knit group in the years that I played here, and it shows in our alumni here 30 years later, big percentage of our same group still keeps in contact, showing up, coming back, being part of the program, so it's great.
It was an incredible experience. You know, we were all very lucky to be able to play here in front of these fans in this this town where we were so heavily supported every night that we played. It was just a phenomenal experience, and very thankful to have that opportunity to be here.
So first of all, having my number retired is just probably the most humbling thing that I've ever been involved in as an athlete by far. So it's extremely humbling. And I've had a lot of really good players that have played here, and including the guys I played with. So tons of great guys I played with, and my number certainly wouldn't be retired if it wasn't for my teammates.
I couldn't be more happy to be here. Honestly, I think it was a blessing in disguise that I ended up here. I think I'd way rather be here than anywhere else. And yeah, I mean, it's phenomenal.
Well, he was his own man, so I let him follow his own path. And it's amazing how things work out. Fate, some might call it, so.
Well, I kind of went over it last season. You know, this is kind of a redo for me. But I don't know. It's still unbelievable that I'm, you know, in this position. I mean, it still doesn't feel like I'm going to be ending my home season here this weekend. But you know, I'm definitely excited. You know, hopefully get a sweep. I mean, it's just, you know, the hard work that we put in. You know, the effort. You know, coming here my freshman year. Not winning the Cactus Cup for like 30 years and winning it that first time was just incredible, and to be able to keep it the whole time I was here is, you know, really cool.
And these ASU weekends, always special, you know, how much does it mean to you going out knowing that you guys will be playing ASU on home ice?
I mean, just the rivalry. I mean, I can't really compare it to any other team that we play. It's just, we always, you know, get up for each other, and just the crowds are always into it, and it's just the atmosphere, I will never get it anywhere else.
You know, what has it meant to you, you know, kind of as a person during your time in college, being a part of this program and being a part of this team?
I've been telling a lot of the guys, you know, since I've been here the longest. My freshman year, it seemed like guys are just here to play hockey. It wasn't really, we weren't really here to win and, you know, strive to get better. And as I've gone through the progressions here, you know, being my fifth year season here, the culture has just changed dramatically. Like, guys are willing to lay bodies out. Guys are willing to put more time on the ice to get better. It's just the culture has changed dramatically from when I started, which is really cool to see.
A
lot of reminiscing. You know, coming in the last week, you just start to have all the memories of, oh, this really is going to be the last time this is going to happen, you know. So I think it's both good and obviously kind of emotional in a sad way, but I think it's going to be a good weekend. It'll be a lot of fun. Yeah, especially like you say, getting that done before this final weekend so I can just kind of focus on having fun and having a good weekend myself. So that was huge, and that was good to get it done with the boys and everything. It was good.
Yeah, and the senior guys you're graduating with, you know, how much did that Cactus Cup, win mean to you guys, you know, as a whole?
Yeah, well, going in every year, you know, that's top goals on the board is winning the Cactus Cup. And to be able to do that all 3 years I played here, I think that was really special. And to do it the last year was awesome, too.
And do you have any, like, favorite specific memories going back over the years here playing at the U of A?
Yeah, well, back to the Cactus Cup. Our freshman year, going into this last weekend, actually, we had to win both games to be able to keep it. And so those were some exciting games when we were able to do that. And so I'd say that was probably one of my best memories looking back.
Try to keep your emotions like level just going into game week. But this weekend's obviously means so much more to the seniors just because it's their last games and the arena. And, you know, it means everything, man. Like this program has shaped us and who we are today. And to be able to go out against ASU, it'll be perfect. Oh, it's awesome, man. You can feel the electricity as soon as you step into the rink on game day. And playing in front of the crowds that we get here in Tucson, you're playing in front of the best fans in the ACHA, so you can't ask for more than that.
And, you know, as a senior winning the Cactus Cup up at ASU, how important was it to go out your senior year knowing that you guys held on to that cup?
Oh, it was so important. Yeah, like being able to instill the kind of dynasty that we left in securing that cup. In the 4 years that I've been here, we've won it every single year, so it was good to get the last one in my senior year.
And do you have any, like, favorite memories from over the years playing here at the U of A or one that stands out to you?
It's funny. I've been thinking about that a lot recently. There's no really one memory that kind of stands out, but it's more just a bunch of small memories, like the little stuff that you're going to remember the most, like in the locker room with the boys and on road trips and just, yeah, mostly just the small things, nothing really in particular.
welcome back, Wildcat fans. Second period of Saturday night hockey here at the Tucson Arena. Final home game of the season in terms of the ACHA. We will have the Coyotes alumni game coming up here. We'll be broadcasting that as well. Senior night, packed house here. Wildcats come into the period with a one-goal lead. Everything's going somewhat swimmingly so far for the Wildcats, and they want to keep it that way. They do give up a goal on the penalty kill. But Roden has looked very beatable, and the Wildcats have been generating a lot of rebound chances out front. Good on the five-on-five. Just really staying out of the box is going to be key for the Wildcats here.
Yeah, and definitely the 11-goal differential here, or shot count, is definitely playing a key part here with the scoreboard.
It's definitely a determining factor of the Wildcats controlling most of the pace of play, and also a reflection of their shot-first mentality, putting up 18 shots alone in the first period. We've seen that a couple times throughout the season where the Wildcats have a very hefty shot lead on a team in the first, then things kind of shift the other way. But if the Wildcats are able to put up 18 a period, I think the results are going to speak for themselves on the scoreboard, as Chad Berman will roll out his top line to start this period. Brody Selman in to take the faceoff against Brendan Studioso. Studioso, the lone goal scorer for ASU. Goals for U of A coming from Connor Ziegler and Will Josephson. And also a two-point night for Cameron Timor. So Timor making the most of his last go-around against ASU. And Selman able to win the faceoff, and we'll get the second period underway. Hedgecoat quickly over to Lowell. Goes middle, gets it around his man. Back to Malco. Puts the shot right into the back of the legs of Lowell. Plord able to get there first, but Malco seals off the lane. Unfortunately for him, though, Cooch seals off his lane, and Wildcats will look to regroup in their end. Matthew Hull not able to get it out clean yet, but gets some support, sticks with it.
Yeah, Matthew Hull did a great job there by pinching that guy off the board so he had nowhere to go with the puck so he could get it some support from his other teammates.
So Malco will back that one in deep. Good job there by Selman to finish his check on Marchand. He calls for a line change, and now it's going to be Cameron Timor. Goes over to Myers. Myers looks middle, tries to go. Can't get it to Mace, but he gets it back. Now Mace along the boards, wraps it around the net, but no one's home, and Marchand will just be content to get that to center ice. As ASU definitely relying on dump and chase. Now Myers tries to go middle, can't get through Marchand. Mace and Myers both commit to the same man, but Lusby on the back check makes it so it's even 3-on-3 going down the ice. Timor in against Kylie Ram. Good stick lift by Timor. Timor over to Myers. Myers, now he gets it around his man. Timor and Myers go in deep. Myers wins the puck battle so far with the body. See if the Wildcats can pull it out of the pile. Lackey's got his man tied up. But as U of A looks to get a couple fresh legs, ASU will dump it right back into the U of A zone. So Timor throws that to the red line, and ASU will throw it right back in.
Yeah, definitely the patience of the Wildcats is really paying off right now. Getting those really good passes, solid passes across to your teammates.
So a good forecheck here by Cosden, but he just overskates it a little bit too much, giving ASU some space and time to get it out for Kylie Ram. Tillman kind of running a pick there on Ziegler. Josephson can't get the puck. ASU now begins the cycle. Down along the boards, into the slot, quick shot. Good block by Will Josephson on Lackey.
And the Wildcats are kind of running around in the defensive zone right now. So ASU is definitely taking advantage of it.
So Fisher had the responsibility to get that one out, and he does a good job too. As Hodgson picks it up, tries to get the pass, can't do it. Good job there. Power move to the middle. They feed it across to Lackey. They try to go back door. Puck still loose. Have no idea how that one didn't end up in the net. The whistle hasn't gone yet. The light went on the goal. Biv thought he had it. Some absolute chaos down there. Not exactly sure what was going on.
Yeah, but Volsik was all the way on the other side of the net. There was an entire net open.
So Bavolsik luckily does not get beat backdoor as ASU, through determination, almost creates a perfect play from side to side. But the Wildcats survived that one.
Yeah, but Volsik with the speed getting across that crease there definitely saved the goal.
So ASU with the first high-quality chance of the second period. Now Franklin, quick shot. That one gets deflected but goes wide. And now Matthew Hull with a nice little turnaround move on Phillips, able to open up some space, try to get the breakout going. Franklin gloves it down. Litwin's going to try to get in there quick. That one comes straight up the middle to the U of A. Walker, nice little move to try to open up a little bit of time for his guys.
The passing from the Wildcats is perfect right now.
And it's been good so far. The Wildcats just want to try to get some kind of cycle going and utilize that passing. But so far, ASU has been stifling it. Now Brody Selman tries to get it to the middle. Across, quick shot. Great save by Roden. He had to come out and shut down Marquis. Timor just couldn't hold that one at the line. So Selman creating a good opportunity there, but Marquis not able to beat Roden. Now a quick shot, but Volsik with a great shoulder save on a hard shot. That one comes through the crease. ASU ramping up their offensive presence. Howsworth tries to throw one on that, and that one gets blocked.
It was a great block there by Timor. Went off his knee pad, so it went totally out of the defensive zone.
So Howsworth to Marchant. Little touch pass to the middle to Plord. Plord with some speed. Quick shot. Glove save by Volsik. Pops right back out, though. Now Marchant blasts one, and that one gets tipped on the way through and in.
It looks like Volsik was a little bit occupied there by the screen. Didn't quite see that puck coming in on him.
And what looked like should have been an out for the U of A ends up in the back of their net. Brody Selman clearly frustrated at the end of that one, but shots from the point. We were talking about Marchant earlier in the game. So that glove save there, Volsik just not able to hold on to it. And Marchant throws one at net. Take shots, good things will happen. 15:47 left to go in the second period, and we are all tied up at two. Now the Wildcats will need to respond yet again. Josh Lesby into the zone. Myers, quick shot. Roden barely gets that one. Comes out of the glove. Puck still loose. And that one hops past, and it's going to be Plord in with some speed. Fisher on him. Quick shot from Plord, and Biv up to the task. And he'll glove that one to get the save. But almost a quick one going the other way for the Sun Devils here.
And the Sun Devils are definitely getting into a roll right now of intensity against the Wildcats, so it's definitely key for the Wildcats to keep that intensity down.
So far this period, ASU has had the better of the play and been the better team, so the Wildcats are going to have to make some adjustments if they're going to be able to get the lead back in this one. So once again, we are all tied up, and we'll see if there's any more PIMs than the last period. Probably not, as both teams try to tidy things up and they know how critical every power play is going to be. Biv will just play that one for Fisher. Fisher up off the boards, goes to Kruk. Kruk over to Palmer. Lesby shadowing him. ASU does a good job to escape the pressure, but not good enough as Myers knocks it in. Mace now takes down his man, able to get to the puck. Mace, good job on the puck battle, but then loses it right to Lackey. Hunter Hodgson's going to have to get back quick as Lackey, one of the faster players, but Hodgson just decides to plant him. That'll work too. Great hit there by Hodgson. So Ram knocks that one down. And ends up at the feet of an ASU player. Now Fisher with Lackey in against him. Fisher able to turn away with it. Only gets it a couple feet up the boards. Now ASU will look to go to the slot. Coming late is the following ASU player, but Biv able to just control that one as Franklin, kind of the trailer that everyone had lost track of.
Yeah, and this is what you were talking about before. ASU's shot count is starting to match U of A's.
ASU out shooting U of A 6-2 so far in this period.
And ASU is definitely controlling this period for the first 6 minutes.
ASU certainly been the better team. Wildcats, though, know they've got another gear than this. So Hull just kind of hold that one up against Volsik. And we'll get an offensive zone draw here for the Sun Devils.
That was definitely a smart play there. Nolan Bavolsik had his back turned to the rest of the players.
So the Wildcats here need to be good in the dot. Always such an important part of winning a hockey game is possession, and the Wildcats a little bit on the back foot right now with 6 minutes gone in the second period. Definitely feels like the ice is tilting down towards Bavolsik. The Wildcats are going to have to actively do something to change that up. So now Cosden. Franklin tries to go middle, only finds hole. Hole now. Tries to go down the boards, gets it far enough for Cosden to get in there. Josephson on the support. He's all over Phillips. So Josephson trying to win a battle. U of A not able to hold it in at the line. Quick shot in there. Phillips going to try to get to it first. U of A now looking to spring a rush out of that. Ziegler and Josephson. Now Walker. Hasn't been able to make too much of an impact here tonight, but Dylan Walker can change the shape of a game quickly in a shift. We'll see what he's able to do tonight. Studioso gets it up to Plord. Plord looks cross ice, gets it, quick shot. That one just goes wide on the glove side of Bavolsik.
And Duke Litwin with the great back check there to block off that weak side pass.
So now Marchant with a couple nice moves, able to hold on to it, but Marquis comes in. Three Wildcats is just too many. So now Cameron Timor tries to drag it around his man, can't quite do it. As the U of A chance start up once again, trying to will this team to victory on a Saturday night in Tucson. Now Roden will just hold on to that, wait for some support.
Roden looks very, very comfortable in the net.
And ASU has looked more comfortable in their own zone compared to last night. They're able to look for more of those stretch passes. Seems like they have a little bit more time and space than they did last night. Malco can't skate onto that one as Cooch got to it first. Selman tries to advance it. Marchant, Jesse Lowell just takes the body though.
That was a textbook hit there, separating the player from the puck.
And now Hodgson at the point, quick shot, that one doesn't make it through. And Marchant has definitely been the best when he's been just able to dangle around, but it's pretty hard to get the puck around Jesse Lowell when he goes straight through you. So 11:58 left to go here in the second period. Ty Marchant for ASU scoring the game-tying goal. And we'll keep an eye on that shot counter as this period goes on. Wildcats only with two shots so far with 8 minutes gone in the second period. Have not really been able to establish any real zone time. So now Lusby gets it over to Selman. And that one will be a quick one and done. Fisher just kind of has to get that into space. Doesn't want to risk gloving it down and giving away a breakaway. Lackey barely escapes a couple checks there. So that one gets deflected up into the netting. And we'll get a face-off back at center ice, I would imagine. It'll come outside the ASU zone, so Wildcats with a little bit more of a strategic advantage playing out of those dots. Oh, no, center ice, ref pointed at the wrong one. It was right all along, should have trusted my instincts. All right, so back to center ice, Kylie Ram in against Jackson Mace. Mace not able to win that one, so Lusby with Mace and Myers trying to get something done here. They were the best line last night. We'll see if they can replicate something here, but Roden able to simply get that one, but Hodgson, great job to keep it in. Lusby couldn't get the tip. Now Palmer behind the net with Lusby all over him. Crux going to try to win a race, but Mace does first. Wildcats, this is what they need. Some sustained zone pressure. Some forecheck, great hit by Josh Lusby on Palmer. Lackey and Kylie Ram able, though, to work together, get that out. Now Lackey in, tries to go around Fisher, can't do it. Almost gets deflected, but Biv just reaches the glove out. Kylie Ram with a very nice move into the slot. Quick shot, that one goes high. Too much time and space here for ASU in the slot. You cannot be allowing skilled guys like that to just have that much time and space to tee off on Bavolsik. Now another quick shot here. That one gets tipped in on the pads. ASU really the better team here. Almost Tillman with a steal. Luckily that one gets tipped, so it won't be icing. As that shot clock inches closer and closer to being even. Josephson trying to get something done on the forecheck. Ziegler in there too. He goes down. Cosden tries to go back to the point to Hedgecoke, and Hedgecoke just decides, I'm not even going to try to play this. I just got to get back. Hole separates the puck from the man, but it still ends up on an ASU stick. Over to Franklin. Franklin, wide intentional shot, maybe looking for a little carom off the boards. Hole in a battle of Phillips, but U of A able to skate out with it. Now a possible 3-on-2 up the ice if they can hustle. Josephson looking middle, tries to get the very sharp angle shot on Roden, but he holds the post. And ASU will come back down the other way as Schultz dumps it in. Bobulsik able to hang on to that one as Kelleher was getting in there quickly.
And the Wildcats are definitely looking a little unorganized in the defensive zone, kind of scrambling to keep possession, trying to get past the puck, get it open ice. Doesn't look like it's working out for them very well right now.
Yeah, and their inability for good defensive zone breakouts is really stifling their chance at any real offense either, as Marquis tries to get that down the boards, can't do it. Quick shot there, Bobulsik, a rebound, and it's going to be a penalty coming here against ASU. Pretty clear cross-check there from number 10, Sean Phillips, as he'll head to the box. And now the Wildcats with a premier chance on the power play to reestablish some momentum. This Wildcat crowd has been a little quiet, but Phillips heading to the box will give him something to yell about, and hopefully a goal will give him something to cheer about. As the Wildcats have just, this has felt like a very flat period from them, drastically different from the first. And from up here, it's not always easy to tell exactly if it's an adjustment ASU made or if U of A just made some of their own adjustments and they're not working. But now here on the power play, a great chance for the U of A to get one back and get some momentum. Mace over to Timor, over to Myers. Myers, who had the lone power play goal last night. Over to Mace. Jackson Mace down low. Jesse Lowell looking middle, back to Timor. They find Myers open, big block shot, it's loose out in front. Timor recovers, quick shot. That one's still bouncing around the crease. Roden's down on his belly. Wildcats still with possession, but Kylie Ram's able to get it out of the zone. While Roden, his instinct is to lay down real quick, full body spray out.
That was a great opportunity there for the Wildcats to get an additional point there on the board. But it looks like it just didn't work out for them.
Wildcats were able to generate some pressure, get a good shot away. Got blocked by an ASU player, but created a rebound. A puck just would not stop bouncing. And the Wildcats will take an outside the ASU zone faceoff. 1:28 left to go in the power play as they're able to win possession. Timor pass just a little bit too hard for Myers to handle. Cooch pressuring on the forecheck. The Wildcats are able to get it over the blue line onside. Myers takes a hard hit, but Lowell's there. Jesse Lowell surveys, goes to Timor, over to Mace. Mace to Timor. Mace, quick shot, didn't get much on it. You can see the frustration from the stick tap. And Mace is going to end up taking a penalty here.
You definitely don't want to see those stick taps. The ASU is definitely going to take advantage of that. He looks very frustrated out on the ice. He keeps getting penalties here. So
that's going to be a fourth penalty for Jackson Mace, who had a great game last night. Goes in the box for hooking this time. So we're going to have 56 seconds of 4-on-4 and then back to an ASU power play.
Yeah, and I believe if he gets one more additional penalty, he's going to be going off the ice.
Garrett Kane, much more familiar with the rules of the ACHA in terms of that. I had no idea that was even a possibility, but if it is, you're going to have to really instill some discipline in Mace. You know, he kind of fans on that one-timer, gets a little bit too desperate trying to get the puck back and goes to the box for a hooking. So some 4-on-4 hockey here as Plourd takes the faceoff against Josephson. Josephson able to win it over to John Shively, and now Josephson. He toe picks and goes down. Plourd gets it, but not able to keep it. Ziegler goes down hard. Now Ram doing a good job, tries to go middle to Plourd. Quick shot, but Bobulsik has to hold the side of the net. So now Timor, and before this power play begins, 4-on-4, you gotta tire some of these ASU players out. Now Connor Ziegler over the line. Timor goes back to him. It's going to be Ziegler trying to get to it first behind the net. Does.
We have some of the most creative players here out on the ice. It's definitely a good thing that they're out here on the 4-on-4.
Shively almost completes the great little move. Can't quite do it. Kruk get it over to Palmer. And with 5 seconds left to go on the ASU penalty, they're just going to hold and get set up for the power play as Phillips, he races out of the box straight to the bench as ASU gets their power play guys on. So Tillman, nice little pass there to Palmer over to Studioso. Studioso, who already has a goal tonight for ASU, over to Lackey. Over to Marchand, back to Lackey. Lackey waits. Quick shot from Tillman. That one's loose out in front. Good job by Chris Hedgecoke down front to make sure there was no easy rebound. Now Studioso with a big shot. That hits his own man out in front. 30 seconds to go on the power play. Tillman at the point. They go down low to Lackey back door. And that pass is too hot. And luckily ASU clears it for the U of A. And they'll get a change here with 16 seconds left to go on the ASU power play, 6:20 to go in the period.
And the Sun Devils definitely are looking very, very good tonight compared to last night with their power plays.
Yeah, Studioso, he dumps it in. Howlsworth's in there too. Cosden gets into a battle. ASU is able to scrape it out. Penalties over to Mace. Ziegler, quick shot, but Volsik with a huge glove save. That's one interesting stat I've always wanted to look at, is how many goals are scored 5-10 seconds after, you know, a penalty expires. Because you see that a lot where, you know, the guy comes out of the box, some tired penalty killers, able to get hemmed in the zone. It does end up being a 5-on-5 goal, but the power play is what drives it. But Biv, who has had a couple, you know, shaky moments with the glove tonight, puck's popping out a little bit more than he'd probably like, but a great one there to hold on to.
Yeah, and there's definitely an adjustment going from 5-on-4 to 5-on-5.
Definitely. So now Myers, he'll try to scrape it down the boards. It ends up being Lusby with it. Over to Mace. Mace tries to get the shot away. He's tied up. Goes for the wraparound. Can't get it. Shively, he's got a shot. Roden still out of the crease. And Roden has been on an adventure here this evening. Stayed out of his net, though, on all his opportunities. Now Lusby. He holds it, switches with Timor. Timor from a knee to Mace. Mace can't get it through back to Myers. Wildcats trying to hold it in the zone. Maybe an opportunity, but just not enough wood to get it deep. And Bavolsik will watch this one go. And that is a little bit of a lucky call there for the U of A, as I think Schultz had beaten out the icing on that one. He was in a full hustle against the U of A players, but luckily the ref's decision goes the way of the Wildcats, and this will come back as an icing.
Yeah, he definitely, for that play there, the forwards kind of stopped up in the neutral zone. You don't want to see that. It's definitely an indication that they needed a change.
And with these rebound opportunities out in front, Roden is so quick to go down, just fully sprawled out, that if a player is able to just be a little bit more cool, calm, and collected, settle that puck down and elevate it, there's room there. Not much room when he's standing, but plenty of room when he's laying down. So Josephson, he goes hard into the boards, but fights through it. Back to Hodgson, over to Fisher. Fisher with a quick shot, that never makes it through. Schultz, Hodgson with a good takeaway there. Cosden will dump it in for Josephson to retrieve. Franklin there, gets it over to Kelleher. Cosden not making things easy though. This line for the Wildcats tries to get some offensive zone time. Hodgson overcommits a little bit there, but luckily some players back. Plord, he's got a lot of space, but Biv can see that one all the way through. Doesn't have to worry about any passes, and now it's going to be Fisher. He'll dump it in and go after his own. So now the Wildcats change out.
Looks like ASU's kind of cherry picking here with Studioso out on the blue line for the Wildcats.
Yeah, Hodgson is aware. But Studioso and Lackey too. Oh, great steal there. Now a quick shot. That one never gets through. But a great steal from Duke Litwin.
Yeah, ASU is definitely recognizing.
Oh, and now a chance for Marquis. Roden just barely stops that one. This line doing a great job, though. Now Holweights can't get a shot through the lane. Kruk gets there first in a battle against Marquis and Litwin. And what looked like, you know, Studioso cherry picking, setting up a big play, came right back, and the U of A get a couple chances out of it. So that one in, Bavolsik just sticks that down, settles it. 3:37 left to go here in the second period. Now Matthew Hole, middle to Selman. Selman with some speed, nice little chip pass around Ram, but just too far ahead of him. So now Howlsworth.
As you can see, there's some more cherry picking going on here. ASU's kind of having trouble getting out of their zone, so they're trying to spread the ice, spread out the players so they can have more opportunities to get passes or skate the puck up.
And Studioso picks that one right up in the middle, but luckily U of A aware to it. But ooh, Kylie Ram would have been backdoor all alone if that pass had gotten through. Studioso takes that off the skates. Wildcats will look to regroup themselves. Malco with Lackey all over him. Good job by Malco to hold on to that puck, and they get it across. Timor with some speed. Over to Jesse Lowell. Jesse Lowell over the line. He gets taken down. Now ASU trying to break out Tillman and Kylie Ram. Got Howlsworth going middle. Lackey on the near side. Putting the three man across, trying to open up those backdoor plays or plays from the slot.
Yeah, ASU's having a lot of success sneaking that backdoor guy in without the Wildcats recognizing it.
I'm not sure if it's a lapse in coverage from the U of A or just ASU having great ice awareness. And now that cherry picking comes out. Phillips goes in.
And that's, I'm not sure if that's going to be a penalty shot or is just going to be a penalty there. I think he was in the motion of shooting yet, so I think it's just going to be a penalty.
It looks like it's just going to be a hooking call for Ryan Fisher. As Phillips, who was cherry picking up at the blue line, ASU waits. They set up that long breakout pass. They connect. And Fisher, in desperation, has to wrap up his man to try to stop a scoring opportunity.
Yeah, sometimes that's the best option there, taking a penalty instead of a goal on the scoreboard.
Yeah, there's very few penalties that coaches are going to encourage, but when they do stop a genuine breakaway scoring chance like that, that's one that you can definitely stomach a bit more so. But 2:11 left in the second, all tied up 2-2. Lots of twos here on that board. Wildcats are going to hopefully kill this penalty and keep it that way moving into the third period. So 2:11 left. Wildcats are going to have to kill off the rest of this period on the penalty kill, where ASU has been most dangerous in this weekend series. U of A not able to clear that one out as Marchand holds it at the point. Now Lackey. Lackey over to Studioso. Studioso tries to go across, sticks in the lane. Marchand to Lackey. Waits. Marchand to Lackey. Back to Marchand. And now that opens up a little bit of room for Tillman. Quick shot there. And Biv, no rebound. Great job there by Bavolsik.
Yeah, Bavolsik's always been a star. Having key moments there, keeping the puck from squirting out from his pads, getting that face-off inside the Wildcats zone.
And ASU running that three-man triangle up high. A little back and forth between Marchand and Lackey, and Tillman just kind of cycles off from the two defenders, gets some room. Jesse Lowell with a big face-off win. Hopefully the U of A can clear it here. Not able to. Held in at the line by Lackey. Now Marchand, nice little move to get away from Lowell. That one gets blocked. The U of A do a good job there. Shively with a good strong stick to make sure that one does get out. Minute 32 left to go in the second period. ASU with a minute 17 left on the power play. Studioso tries to go down the boards. Shively in against two ASU players in Palmer and Tillman. Studioso gets it around the boards. Back to Lackey.
We're going to have 1 minute left here in the penalty kill for the Wildcats.
So they're going for that high triangle again. Quick shot there. Good block by Jesse Lowell, and Shively with another good strong stick to make sure that gets down the ice. So Roden decides to try to pick up an assist, and instead he's going to pick up an icing. So with 41 seconds left to go on the power play, this will come down into the ASU zone. And yeah, a face-off win here. You just win it back to the defenseman, have the defenseman circle, kill off this 40 seconds.
Yeah, and with how this game is going, Studioso didn't really want to reach for that puck, especially on the blue line. It's a really dangerous place to reach. get out of body position, you can really get hurt.
And you can also get that puck going the other way, but ASU able to do what they need to do and win that faceoff with 45 seconds left to go in the period, 33 seconds left to go on the penalty. Bavolsik, he'll knock that one down. Hold, a little bit of hesitancy there, but Hole is able to get there. That one rides the dasher, stays in the zone. 30 seconds left to go in the period. Over to Howlsworth. He tries to get it deep. Now Cosden plants his man into the boards. Hole can't escape the zone, though. Plored with it. 19 seconds left to go in the period. U of A trying to survive this final moments of this penalty kill in this period. Josephson tries to get there first. It comes to Fisher. There was only 5 seconds left, though, not able to spring Ziegler. So as this period winds down, the Wildcats do a good job killing off that penalty, making sure this game goes into the third period even. But I gotta say, if the Wildcats replicate that second period, it's gonna be tough to pull this one out in the third. A very different tale of two periods so far tonight.
I would definitely agree with that. ASU is switching up their playing style. Wildcats are trying to get used to it. And ASU was definitely on top this period.
And as we look at the shot counter, yeah, ASU brings that within four, maybe even a little bit less with the power play. But Wildcats have some adjustments to make. Berman's got a speech to do. I'm sure there's a couple seniors that are going to have a couple words about what needs to get done in this third period. We'll be back to bring you the final period of action here from the Tucson Arena in just a little bit. Stick around during the intermission for some of the interviews with the seniors. Sebastian Janik with Garrett Kane. This is Wildcat Hockey.
When I came here, I really didn't know what to expect. I thought it was just like a small organization with the school playing hockey, and came here and it was everything and more, and just very grateful for the teammates along the way and just very happy to be a part of this program. Very happy it's against Arizona State. It's awesome to play those guys for the last game of the year. We're going to have a big crowd, but I don't know, just very happy. It's been amazing to be a part of this program.
Do you have any favorite memory going back over the years here specifically that stands out? Or?
I mean, anything just involving the post-win. I mean, the post-win in the bus, post-win on the plane sometimes, just the locker room, just, I guess, the camaraderie in the locker room. It's very special here.
Yeah, it's been crazy. I know when I first came down here freshman year, I had no idea what I was getting myself into, and it's been the best move I ever could have made. Made so many good friends and buddies on the team, and relationships that'll last a lifetime. It's weird, man. I'm telling you, like, I feel like I just got here. I'd like to have a couple more years, that's for sure. It'll be a fun time this weekend, though. ASU in town, so it's a good way to go out.
Do you have like a memory that stands out to you, you know, during your time here at the U of A?
Honestly, I think anytime we're playing at home and the fans here, best fans in the ACHA, I think that's probably my best memory.
How important was it to finish up, you know, your career here knowing that, you know, you won that cup yet again?
I think, yeah, more importantly, when I got here, we'd already won it, so it was important not to lose it for anyone, you know, and for the history of the program. So it's been a really good time, and winning the Cactus Cup this year is a great way for all of us to go out.
A lot. Helped me grow on and off the ice as a person. And all the guys, you know, here and that were here in the past helped me in developing. And I just want to leave that for the younger guys here. Oh, it's always fun. The atmosphere, the fans, they bring a whole nother level. So that brings the best out of us. And, we're going to try to get it done this weekend.
And do you have any, like, favorite memory from over the years here at the U of A or anything specific?
Everything we kind of had to battle through. You know, COVID ending, nationals, so we didn't get a nationals my freshman year. Taking trips up to Chandler for practice when we didn't have ice here. Just like small stuff like that those are the best memories because we had to come together as a team and we had to work through them. And they were challenges in the moment, but we definitely overcame them. And yeah, that's what I'll miss the most. Biggest memory.
going into the last senior night game?
Oh, it's incredible. The atmosphere is insane, and it's almost surreal. Like, I can't even find the words to describe what I'm feeling like the last couple of games with all my boys.
Welcome back, Wildcat fans, to the third period of the final home game. And welcome back again, Wildcat fans, to the final period of the final home game of the season. All tied up going into the third period, but the Wildcats going to need to have a very different period than they did in the second, as ASU absolutely got the better of play as the period went on. So some work to be done, but luckily still all tied up here at two going into the third. Garrett, what do you think the Wildcats really need to focus on tidying up in this period?
I definitely think they need to watch out for the cherry picking. The changes in the game that ASU has made in the second period really paid off for them, and they really controlled the second period. So the Wildcats really just need to keep up the solid passing, making sure they have zone coverage, not leaving any open space for the ASU to get a odd man chance on Bivolsik.
And we did see what they were trying to do, cherry picking. Phillips was able to get out away on a breakaway. Ryan Fisher had to end up taking a penalty in order to shut that chance down. But the Wildcats shut down the power play, were able to kill it off successfully. And we'll go into the third period here, all tied up at two. So as we get ready for the face-off here, senior night at the Tucson Arena, a big game for everyone involved, and the Wildcats are going to look to get things started off the break. Top line for the Wildcats have really been held off the score sheet, well, literally been held off the score sheet the last two games.
And Hull and Hedgecoke in the back end have really been a crucial point here for the Wildcats, getting the puck up into the ASU zone.
And part of the reason the Wildcats really struggled so much with offense last period was having to play so much defense and just running around their own zone, so that definitely needs to be tidied up. And though that shot differential, David Cummings, The Wildcats are going to need to get some more shots. Good shot there from Hull. Just goes wide as Malco tries to get that one with the tip. Lowell takes the body and makes so ASU has to just dump it in. Matthew Hull fakes the wraparound. Nice little move there. So now Hull, those are the clean breakouts the Wildcats really need as Selman dumps it in low for Malco. Malco against Howlsworth, battling in the boards. Selman's got his stick tied up around Kylie Ram. Kylie Ram's just kind of laying on the puck, but that one will get dumped out. A little bit of a strange sequence there in the first minute of the third period. Thank you to everyone who's tuned into the live streams over the course of the season, everyone who's been able to make a game. Definitely this team would not be able to survive without the community behind it, and hopefully the Wildcats can get something done here. Jackson Mace, 3-on-2. Mace tries to spin it around, go middle, shot doesn't get off. Lowell just couldn't sweep that one through the legs. And now Mace again, quick shot here. Shively tries to get it still out in front. Mace, Roden's down and out. Puck's in, it's in! They score! John Shively, broken play down in front. Roden on his belly, and Shively's the first one to be able to settle that puck down, elevate it, and score.
Yeah, that was a great goal there.
Just some hard work down in front. A couple great chances didn't pan out, but the Wildcats stick with it. Puck's on the net. Shively gets the original chance that gets blocked. Puck just keeps bouncing around and comes over to Shively on the far side as Roden not able to hold the post. And the Wildcat fans appreciate the effort there.
Like I was saying at the beginning of the game there, the best opportunity to get some points on the board against Roden is getting him down on his knees. And as you can see there, a ton of players in front of the net. Roden can't really move that much when he's on the ground.
So the ref signaled goal. Definitely looks like that's going to stand after ASU's coach has a discussion with the refs.
Yeah, there definitely was some speculation there. The puck kind of went off the Wildcats' skate.
The number 5, John Shively. The assist goes to number 4, Jackson Mays, and number 18, Jesse Lowell. That's Shively from Mays and Lowell. Time of your Wildcat goal, 1 minute 19 seconds in the third period.
So now Fisher picks up, comes late on the rush, picks that one up, dumps it into the corner. Lusby goes cross ice to Fisher. He can't get there first. Plord, little turnaround move, trying to generate some space. Mays recognized the play wasn't over, but now he's going to go for the change. So Jackson Mays having a little bit of a tough night with his trips to the box, but a lot of hard work there by him. Gets that go-ahead goal, and almost a little bit of a lackadaisical chance there created by Bavolsik as Plord was coming in. Now ASU looking to respond. They get a quick shot. That one didn't miss by much as it got bodied down in front. So ASU on the return shift going right back at the Wildcats. Plord now with it. He'll wrap it around to Studioso. Studioso takes a bump there. 7:26 left to go in the third period. Wildcats up by one on the go-ahead goal from John Shively. But down below the net, dangerous place for ASU to be. The Wildcats hemmed in their own zone after scoring that goal, but Hedgecock, one of those veteran seniors, looking to get it out, and they do. Myers can only get it as far as the red line, though. His hole has been out there for a pretty long shift here.
And you can see the different dynamic here with Arizona putting a point on the board. They're definitely a lot more intense, keeping the pace up, moving their feet, getting solid passes here.
And Kosden able to dump that one in, gets there first. Good job. Eat away at that clock a little bit more, and now Ziegler with a dogged puck battle. Ziegler goes around, back to the point, into the skate to Timor, but he's able to quickly settle it down. Kosden goes out in front of Josephson. Josephson again, just off the pad of Roden. Just couldn't quite elevate that one, but a great chance for Will Josephson, who already has one here tonight. Kelleher tries to go around Shively, not able to do so, but ASU trying to keep possession, not able to do so. Now John Shively, the go-ahead goal scorer for the U of A.
Yeah, something I'm seeing with Roden, he doesn't really throw his shoulder into the goal post. He kind of just puts his glove up. I think that's because he's a super big goalie.
And the Wildcats are going to take an interference penalty here. Not sure if you saw that, Garrett, but...
Yeah, I did not see that interference call.
There was a whole lot of nothing going on. Wildcats had possession. ASU isn't... So somehow it's off camera for us, I think, but trying to watch the replay back. So Ziegler there. That is... Okay.
Yeah, that
So Ziegler kind of goes into the... That is a tough call. I'm going to leave it at that.
I believe his intention was to go to the bench for a change and just kind of got caught up with the ASU player. Well, it's kind of unfortunate.
I mean, there was less contact than in flag football. That's just a tough call, especially because Connor Ziegler has had such a great game. He had the first goal. He has worked incredibly hard on the forecheck and the puck battles, and that is definitely a rough one to see. But the Wildcats, no win comes without adversity. So the Wildcats here back onto the penalty kill.
And Berman's really showing you how he's a great coach there, coaching his players on the board, on the bench.
I think the refs are having a bit of a discussion here about maybe the call itself and where to put the faceoff. So it's interesting, not sure if you might know, Garrett, better than me, but since that was a penalty, why it comes out of the U of A zone?
I'm not really sure. That might have been because... Because usually when you get a penalty, it's going to be where the whistle was blown, it's going to be a dot back.
So
but that was a dot forward.
So the refs had a discussion, decided to put it there, but no matter what, ASU is on the power play.
Yeah, so I think the head ref kind of realized that was kind of a fluff penalty there.
Oh, I think it was more of there was a deflection because, yeah, so let's not overanalyze the ref's thinking too much. But either way, ASU on the power play. Studioso, the big shot. Palmer out in front, big body on the screen. And now Marchand, he has a goal for ASU tonight. He's been good. Lackey tries to go no-look pass to Studioso. They almost connect. Marchand goes down low. Marchand now back to the middle. Studioso, quick shot. Bibb has to fight that one off and fight off an ASU player as he holds the post.
And Marchand's doing a great job of quarterbacking the play up on top.
And Lackey's down here in what looks like a lot of pain. Lackey and Bavolsik kind of got tangled up at the side of the net as Bavolsik went to go hold the post. Not sure from this angle what happened to Lackey, but he's up on his own accord. He'll skate it off or at least try to.
We're going to have 1 minute left here on the 5-on-4.
So half the penalty has been killed. Lackey in a good bit of discomfort here. Just couldn't quite see what happened as he got tangled up with Bibb at the side of the net. You watch the replay back here a little bit. So Bibb maybe moving across kind of gets him in the back of the legs with a stick possibly, but it looked like Lackey was in just all kinds of pain. So just kind of a strange way to go down, but over halfway through this penalty kill, and you can see two ASU players up at the blue line cherry picking, trying to get something in behind for a breakaway, but it's going to be Plord who skates it over. Quick shot, glove save, Bavolsik.
Yeah, ASU's definitely playing a very interesting power play, putting two guys up on the Wildcats blue line, trying to pull all of the players back so they have more room to start the play behind the net on the ASU side.
14:51 left to go here in the third period. Wildcats ahead by one on the go-ahead goal from Shively, but they need to kill this penalty still. Kruk back to Plord. Looks middle, tries to go there. Fisher says no, and then Fisher takes the body as well. Great play by Fisher. Now Kruk back to Plord. Back to Kruk. Quick shot, Pavolsik. Good positioning there to get in front of that one. I don't think he saw it.
That went straight into his chest there.
Ooh, and a dangerous one out in front just goes wide. They're trying to go out in front to Franklin, but luckily for the Wildcats, Franklin not able to get a stick on it. And Josh Lusby, full head of steam, forces Roden to have to hold this one, and that'll do it for the penalty to Ziegler. So good for Connor to see doesn't get punished for something that maybe shouldn't have been punished for in the first place, but his team supports him with a good penalty kill. And all is well. And now a big hit there from Brody Selman. As Jesse Lowell tries to drag it around his man, able to do so for one, can't quite do it for two. But Jesse Lowell So powerful down the board, so hard to stop. Wildcats still end up in the zone. This is out in the slot. Quick shot there. Roden fights that off. Lowell with a rebound chance. Now Selman tries to throw it out in front, only finds Tillman. Because Selman knew that Roden was down and out, but now maybe a chance here. Lackey, though, not able to get to it, and Biv comes out. Confident play. Jesse Lowell takes a hard hit from Cooch along the boards. Palmer goes through Timor a little bit there, something you don't see too much.
I think he let up there a little bit so he didn't get an interference call.
Yeah, good smart play from another senior veteran. Definitely going to miss watching Cameron Timor play in a Wildcat uniform. Now Mace over Myers, shoots, Roden, save, rebound. Such a juicy rebound out on the other side, and Josh Lusby just couldn't quite get there to gobble it up. But shot first mentality on Roden will not hurt you. Myers, great pass to Mays. Mays waiting to go back, just too pretty with it. And they try to go for the tic-tac goal highlight reel style, but Mays had a lot of chance to maybe get that one away. And now ASU with a chance of their own. Plord waits, quick shot. That one just goes wide, but didn't miss by much. So after the Wildcats turn down a chance to shoot, ASU from the middle of the slot in a dangerous spot.
Yeah, that's going to be the second time there this period where it's been a three-on-three, three-on-two, where they try to pass it into the slot and it goes into the possession of ASU. I think the better option would be get a quick shot off there and have it squirt out the pad.
That was a beautiful little move between Myers and Mays, no doubt about that.
That was a very great play there, but
a little bit too unselfish there from Mays trying to go back door, because we do know that Jackson has a great shot, just like Jesse Lowell last season. You know, guy with a great wrist shot just sometimes turns down the chance to shoot a little bit too much. But anyway, we'll play on. Wildcats still have the lead. Don't want to rag on our own guys too much as Connor Ziegler tries to get a quick shot away, just not able to do so. Josephson, though, great job to retrieve that puck. Now a quick shot from Fisher. Roden has to blocker that one into the corner. But ASU, no chance of getting out easily. They're over the blue line now, though. Hunter Hodgson, what a great move from him. Great stick. Now he just tries to get it in deep, but he definitely broke up a scoring opportunity there.
And ASU's had a lot of success going through the neutral zone with some speed.
Hodgson gets enough on that, but Walker just can't get it down. Wildcats really need to get this out of the zone here, as there's a couple mismatched pairings, it seems like, in terms of who's got who. That one comes out to the side of the net. Biv tries to hold it, but it's not there. Litwin gets in. Puck is still loose, no whistle. Puck still bouncing around, and it's going to end up being a rule of hand pass finally. Hunter Hodgson and Dylan Walker. Got to think that's going to end up being a call there. Not sure exactly what started that. Something really got them riled up.
Yeah, the whistle was blown there, and he was still trying to get the puck into the net. See right there, the whistle's blown.
He's still going for it, yeah. So
that's definitely not okay.
Wildcats not appreciating.
But then again, the retaliation wasn't okay either. So it looks like they're both going to be going to the box.
Yeah, probably number 28, Kelleher, most likely for unsportsmanlike conduct, I can guess. Duke Litwin is one of the other seniors who's close with Bavolsik. He's not going to let anything happen to his goalie. So Kelleher kind of throwing the disrespect, smacking at the puck after the whistle is gone. And because of that, we will once again probably not be playing 5-on-5, has been the case for a lot of this game.
Yeah, and ASU really showing their strength right now, getting pucks to the net. The score right now, or the shots on goals, 33-26. So they're still hanging in there, matching U of A's shots on goal here. And we've seen in the past that teams have really caught up with shots on goal. U of A kind of tends to slow down a little bit in the second and third period. So hopefully they can keep this lead, one goal lead against ASU, and finish out the night for senior night.
Yeah, that one goal lead, always a little tenuous against any team in the ACHA, most likely. A lot of guys rely on quick strike offense, so we'll go to 4-on-4 here, 2 minutes apiece for Litwin and Kelleher. good to see matching calls there. It was a little bit, the optics originally without seeing what Kelleher did looked like U of A was definitely going to the penalty kill, but.
On number 28, William Kelleher. 2 minutes for roughing. Wildcat penalty on number 26, Duke Litwin. 2 minutes for roughing. Both penalties at 8 minutes, 38 seconds in the third period.
So Timor tried to hit Myers on a breakaway, almost gave it to Studioso, but luckily Timor still got it here. Fans on that one, though, that could be dangerous going the other way, but he defensively recovers.
Yeah, definitely keeping the cool in that play. Timor came out on top of the puck.
Yeah, the poise of a veteran. Unfortunately, he does give it away, but doesn't get frustrated, doesn't worry about it, goes right back at it and steals it back. But now it's Tillman for ASU. He tries to work it to the center, not able to get through three Wildcats. So we're about halfway through this four-on-four. Matthew Hull with a big burst of speed. Josephson driving the net. Hull goes all the way around. So four-on-four, that extra ice. Wildcats try to use their speed, not able to do so. Plord gets it to Howlsworth.
Great back check there by Connor Ziegler.
Drop pass to Plord. He tries to throw a sharp angle one on Bavolsik. He's not able to glove it. Puck still loose, but Hull comes away with it. Halfway through the third period here at the Tucson Arena on a Saturday night in Tucson. Marchant definitely got in the way of Fisher, but refs don't see anything wrong with that. Now Josephson with his positioning is able to cause some problems here in the ASU zone. That one gets pinned behind the boards, dueling number 11s. Josephson and Plord, Lackey in there as well, and it's going to be ASU that comes away with it. Marchant crosses with Lackey. Lackey tries to go across. Great stick there by Fisher. That was a set play that Marchant and Lackey know they can connect on, and they almost did, but now Plord back to the point as these penalties are set to expire. Out in front, just hits Lackey and comes down. Back to 5-on-5 as Selman picks it up and hoists it into the neutral zone.
Yeah, the defense on the Wildcats are definitely making an impact on the scoreboard also.
So now Selman and Lowell working together on the forecheck. That one just kind of gets banked into the corner. Lowell absolutely buries his man. Wildcats not able to keep it in the zone, though. And this could be a possible 2-on-1, but just out of the reach of Tillman, luckily for the Wildcats. Now the puck kind of floating in no man's land as Franklin gets to it first. But Shively will get to it as Lowell pinches off his man. Mace was looking for that breakaway. Looking over his shoulder, hoping for the...
Went right on the edge of the glass there and went out of play.
So, definitely a little bit of a better pace here from the Wildcats, a much improved third period.
Yeah, the one change I'm seeing from the Wildcats is the defense are really making an impact, skating the puck up, making better passes, and definitely halting those 3-on-2s and 2-on-1s there.
Yeah, the lack of odd man rushes has definitely been evident because ASU definitely relies on those. U of A haven't had many odd man rushes either, so kudos to ASU for having some responsible defense as well, but they might have to get more and more desperate as this period winds down with 8 minutes left to go in the third, just a little over 8 minutes left to go in the third. But now maybe a chance for ASU. What a dangle there by Palmer, but Biv is up to the task, does not let him go five hole. Now Lusby over to Myers. Myers and Mace. Just gets knocked off the stick of Myers, though, as they're not able to connect in the neutral zone. But Myers gets to it first. Was hoping Lusby would be out in front, just not quite there. Lusby closes the distance very quickly as Myers puts his man into the boards. Now Myers tries to feed Lusby. Lusby stops up, waits. Quick shot there from Lusby. Timothy scores! Josh Lusby! What patience! What a goal! Screen out in front from Mays. And Josh Lusby gets rewarded. He was the hero up at Oceanside with two goals, and he's the hero here tonight, putting the Wildcats ahead by two. The seniors coming out to play.
Yeah, it's definitely a big sigh of relief there for Josh Lusby, getting a point on the board for senior night.
You talk about that shot first mentality. There's just a screen of two guys in front of Roden. He can't see anything. And Lusby picks the blocker side. So good overall guy, Josh Lusby, picking up an incredibly important goal in this third period.
That was a really great shot choice there with the screens going blocker side.
And Lusby just recognized he had time and space. He didn't have to rush anything. He doesn't overthink it, doesn't try to go for too many passes, just throws one on net.
Red Bull! Give it to number 23! He's a senior! Josh Lusby! The assist goes to number 15, Sam Myers. That's Lusby with a one-timer from Sam Myers. Time of your Wildcat goal, 12 minutes, 24 seconds in the third period.
So now there's going to be a hooking call coming. So we will go back to not 5-on-5 hockey, which has been a very common staple of this game here tonight. Bit of a staple of all UAASU games, but it's going to be Will Josephson going to the box for hooking. So just as all the momentum goes back from the work from Josh Lusby, now a big penalty kill is required here. This is at least the second time this game where the Wildcats have scored and then taken a penalty almost immediately after, which with a two-goal lead isn't quite as detrimental, but it definitely halts the flow of momentum a little bit. But then again, you score a goal and you watch your penalty killers get the job done. That could make this last 5 minutes feel pretty good for this Wildcat Hockey Club, but they got to focus on the task at hand. And now Marchant, who's been working it all up at the point all game, and now Matthew Hull just takes his time. Avoids hitting the linesman by about 2 millimeters, but that's just how accurate Matthew Hull is with a wrist shot. That's what you get when you get a guy of that skill caliber. So now ASU, once again, trying to get something done with the man advantage. Studioso wraps it around, and they go to Lackey at the point. Lackey and Marchand have been the two ignitions for this power play, and they shoot and they score. Brendan Studioso gets the one-timer. Goes low, far side, and beats Bavolsik, and just like that, the Wildcats do have a one-goal lead, but that ASU bench is feeling a lot better than they did 40 seconds ago.
Yeah, that was a textbook power play there, getting that cross-ice pass, and then the one-timer. It's a little hard for Bavolsik to transition from post to post, so he had a really nice open net for ASU.
And Studioso just settles that down and walks right into it. The leading goal scorer for ASU with 2 goals on the evening, and you can see why he's their leading goal scorer. A great one-timer there from him. So now the Wildcats will have to get things settled down again. You're playing with a one-goal lead again, so the details have got to be there. Lusby tries to chip it through, gets knocked down. Studioso gets it over, and now ASU with some room in the offensive zone. They try to go cross-seam again. Almost gets there, but stays in at the blue line. Wow, I don't know how that got kept in. Great active sticks there. Timor finds Mace. So now Jackson Mace with Myers and Lusby. Nice little pass to Myers. Myers shot, scores! Sam Myers wrist shot, wired, top shelf, 2-goal lead again.
Now they definitely gave him a response there from being 1-goal differential back to 2-goal differential.
So the best line that came to play at Oceanside came to play again tonight. And Jackson Mace, beautiful feed to Myers. And Myers, just no hesitation. What a shot from Myers. So that line comes out and immediately responds. But what a wrist shot there. Barely even saw the twine get tickled.
Give it to number 15, Sam Myers! The assist goes to number 4, Jackson Mays, and number 10, Hunter Hodgson. That's Myers from Mays and Hodgson. Time of your Wildcat goal, 14 minutes, 10 seconds in the third period.
So the Wildcats, after that huge goal, will now be going right back onto the power play.
We have Kruk in the box there for interference.
Yeah, Jesse Lowell did not have the puck, and Kruk made no hesitation about burying him. You can't do that. So the Wildcats here, from what looked like ASU had seized the momentum back, just a complete polar opposite shift the other way. So Sam Myers showing his scoring prowess, and now the Wildcats, Myers has it again. Myers, quick shot, just goes wide on Roden, but Myers not afraid to use that wrist shot. Selman without a stick gets hooked, but is finally able to get back to his stick now as this one comes out of the zone.
And it looks like Bivolsik is going to dump the puck back for Timor.
So with a 1:35 left to go on the power play and 5 minutes left to go in the period, now it's Lowell in, goes across. Mays just can't get a shot off. Selman comes barreling in, and that's going to get everything going. Let's just watch this unfold. Sometimes silence and visuals are a lot better. It's Jesse Lowell bucket off U of A ASU. What could be better? Definitely excited to see the photos from the photographers from that scrum. Because when buckets are off and guys are going at each other, that produces about the best pictures possible. And Jesse Lowell is going to be getting ejected here.
Yeah, there's only 5 minutes left here.
And Howsworth is going to be done too.
Yeah, you get two players getting kind of fired up towards the game. It's definitely a safer bet to eject those players.
So just absolute chaos in the final 5 minutes. So Jesse Lowell, Mace, who almost had a great opportunity. Selman just comes in late. Selman gets manhandled, and Jesse Lowell, who is very close with Brody Selman. They call each other big brother and little brother.
Yeah, Jesse Lowell there for a second was fighting two people.
Yeah, so Jesse Lowell is obviously known as the bigger brother, yep, as he literally fights two people. As the ASU player,
it's gonna be Kelleher.
For Kelleher, for some reason, seems excited by the result, even though they're losing by two and multiple guys are getting ejected. So it looks like Selman's gonna go too.
I can understand why Selman was getting ejected there. He kind of toppled the ASU player over on top of Roden. That can be kind of dangerous.
So Selman and Lowell ejected. There goes two-thirds of your top line. Luckily, the second one is played like a first line. But it's the final game of the season. ASU, U of A. If anyone had any doubt just how fun these games are, now you know. If you do have a chance to make it down next season, everyone that we can get into this building, we appreciate so much. We appreciate the support, all the fans on the live stream.
Yeah, and it looks like Hole is going to be going over as the center to talk to the ref. It's going to be Hole and Lackey.
So Hole, the most senior member of that assistant captain group. Well, also Brody Selman, assistant captain, is gone. So you get your captain and your assistant captain gone. And now Duke Litwin's going to have a little conversation with Lackey. So 4:58 left to go. Only thing, though, for the Wildcats, two of your most effective players get ejected, while for ASU, the two guys you're losing, you probably don't mind seeing go off the ice to trade for that, Howsworth and Kelleher, for Lowell and Selmans. And ASU's book is probably going to be a pretty good trade.
Now, Roden's net is still off of the goal line.
We'll see if they get around to resolving that. I'm sure there's some personal disputes they want to settle first, then they'll get to the technical stuff. We'll see what comes out of this in terms of penalties, in the sense of if it'll be even or if it'll anyone will get an extra. Because Jesse Lowell was literally wrestling two ASU players at the same time, which is not an easy thing to do. But then again, Jesse Lowell literally reminds me more of a guy who works in a coal mine than a hockey player. He's just built like a tank. He's a tough player on the ice and a great leader off the ice. So to see him go, definitely someone's going to have to step up on this U of A bench and be a little bit more of that leader.
Yeah, Jesse Lowell is definitely very, very good on his skates. Yep, you don't really see him get knocked down too often.
No, he's strong on his skates, strong guy overall, puts in a lot of work off the ice to be able to do that. But he will not be finishing out this game here, and neither will Brody Selman, as both of them have been sent to the locker room.
Based on past scrums in front of the net, usually Jesse Lowell and Brody Selman are directly in the middle of almost every single one of those.
Well, they definitely have a bit of a relationship. You know, obviously I'm always going to make Bruins references as a Bruins fan, but kind of that Bergeron-Marchand relationship, a little bit of that big brother, little brother. I don't know if either of them would appreciate being compared to Brad Marchand, but they're a tandem that sticks up for each other. If Selman has someone go at him, Lowell's probably going to be the next guy in. Same way around with Lowell. Those two guys very close off the ice, traveled to Israel together along with Duke Litwin to play in the Maccabi games before the season started. And that off-ice chemistry has contributed to their on-ice chemistry over the course of this season, that he's been one of the best duos. A little bit quiet in recent games, though, but national tournament still got plenty of time. So ASU getting an additional 2 minutes, and we will get a 5-on-3 here for a minute and a half. So 5-on-3. So Marchand.
A 10-minute misconduct. Sun Devil penalty on number 28, William Kelleher. A 10-minute misconduct. Sun Devil.
This could take a little while, so I'm going to come back in while the U of A is in the zone because there's a lot of penalties to sort out after that. But Walker over to Hole. Over to Malco. Malco to Hole. They play catch back and forth now. They try to go down low over to Malco. He's looking for a lane to Hole. Down to Walker. He takes a quick shot off the pads of Roden. So Walker positioned down almost at the goal line looking for that sharp angle shot. Josephson on the power play as well. Now Hole back to Walker. Holds, waits, back to Hole. He looks for a lane, can't find one. Now Malco, quick shot, does get blocked. 26 seconds left on the 5-on-3. They want to get as many shots as possible. Hole with a big shot. That barely goes wide low on Roden. So 17 seconds left on the 5-on-3. Bavulsic will get this quick up to Hole. But there's no other Wildcats on the ice there for Walker, but they get it to him. Walker goes around Studioso, holds on to it. Mace now. Mace out in front. Quick shot. Shy. Oh, that was Myers absolutely teed off on that one. Didn't miss by much. Crux out of the box. So 5-on-4. Now it could go the other way. Timor is going to have to hustle. Crux. Timor. What a great job by Timor to do just enough to break up the play but not take a penalty. The seniors showing up tonight in Tucson.
As a defense, that was definitely one of the best plays to make there with a break.
And Studioso gets in all alone, goes top shelf, pops the water bottle again, and that's going to be a hat trick goal for Brendan Studioso, shorthanded. Just a breakdown in coverage there, and Studioso gets all alone and just has too much time to pick his spot. So the Wildcats, after not converting on a 5-on-3, get a little bit unlucky with it going the other way. Bavulsic comes out to play it. Hole has it. And it just ends up. So after Timor's great play, I think there's just a bit of a breakdown in coverage, and it comes out to Studioso. Trying to look back at the replay here, and yeah, Studioso just comes across the blue line, plenty of time and space, and now he's going to do the same thing again. Studioso tries to go middle to Tillman. A one-goal game now with 3 minutes left to go.
And we are back to 5-on-5 hockey.
And without Brody Selman and Jesse Lowell, this team is skill-wise down two of their best guys. A quick shot there. That one didn't miss by much. Hodgson's got to get this out of the zone. ASU feeling like a big comeback is possible if they keep at it, especially if they keep getting the puck to Studioso. But now here's Josephson. He's got a goal of his own tonight. He goes around Plord. Josephson trying to battle through. Comes out into the slot. It's going to be ASU with the jump. 2:25 left to go in the third period. A great back-and-forth battle here tonight as ASU brings it within one shorthanded. They'll throw that one. That'll get deflected way up into the netting.
And even though Fisher hasn't had much ice time tonight, he has really made an impact every single shift, making the ASU force their way to the boards when they go inside the Wildcats zone. And that's what defense is all about. You definitely want to give ASU the worst shooting opportunities as possible, and that usually leads to shots from all the way on the boards.
So the Wildcats are going to have to dig deep here, stick to their systems, and the timeout will come here from the Sun Devils as they look to draw something up, probably a set play off this face-off.
Yeah,
go ahead, Garrett.
And ASU has had a lot of success with their face-off, so this is a really good opportunity for ASU to put another point on the board and tie this up and maybe even draw it into overtime.
And that is something the Wildcats do not want to see happen. You got a two-goal lead, a 5-on-3, and then all of a sudden with 2 minutes left, you're clinging to a one-goal lead. Wildcats are going to have to bear down here and make sure that they just get pucks up and out of the zone as quickly as they can. All three goals, Studioso has scored. Quick shot opportunities. They didn't need to cycle it too much. They didn't need to set up too much. Just get the stick, get the puck on his stick and let him fly. So the U of A is going to have to be very, very astute to that as they all gather around, have one last chat with each other as they get ready for the most important 2 minutes and 14 seconds of the season. These are the moments all these guys play for. Home ice, great crowd in attendance, senior night, one goal lead. This is where the Wildcats can show what they're made of as Mace comes in to take the faceoff against Lackey. Mace with some support from his wingers. Wildcats are able to win it. 2:10 left to go in the third. Luckily they get that one out, and it's going to be Josh Lusby with a lot of speed. Drops it over to Mace. Mace looking, goes middle, almost finds Myers on the spin around pass.
It looks like Myers wasn't really expecting that pass to come in so hot on him.
Mace tries to go to Lusby. Now they just knock this one down into the zone. 1:48 left to go in the period. And now Hull. He'll be content to wrap that one around as the Wildcats get some fresh bodies on the ice. Now the Wildcats through the neutral zone. Mace not able to hold on to it. Lusby needs to get off of that change. The Wildcats don't worry about too many men on the ice. Hole, that one just dies off the boards but comes out far enough. A minute 24, Roden's getting ready to hop onto that bench. I can imagine as soon as they enter the zone, Studioso does so. Roden all the way out of his net pretty much, but he decides to head back to the crease. Wildcats just trying to make sure that ASU can't get too solid a possession. We'll see if Roden goes on the rush here. Yep, there he goes. So Wildcats, the ASU is going to have an extra attacker. Studioso not able to get through. Palmer now.
It's going to be 6-on-5 here. Pulled the goalie. Roden is sitting on the bench.
So extra man for ASU. 48 seconds left to go in the period. Similar to last night, this tension, this anxiety. Less than a minute left to go with the extra attacker out. And at the point now, Marchand. Great job there from Connor Ziegler, and he'll go for the empty net, but Marchand gloves it down. But Ziegler, what an effort there.
And great job there by Hull, keeping his cool in front of the net.
Studioso wraps it around. Bavolsa comes out to play it, decides to go up through the middle, and that one's going to be offside. So luckily for the Wildcats, with 10 seconds left, this one gets deflected in. Josh Lusby beats out the ice, and can he get a second? And he does! Josh Lusby calls game. That is it. Hand over the throat, game over. And the Wildcats put the dagger in the Sun Devils and finish off their season with a win on home ice on senior night. Unless I just curse them and ASU scores twice in 20 seconds, but guessing that will not happen. But Garrett, what hustle from Josh Lusby.
Yeah, Josh Lusby has a great game. Definitely a great way to end off the season, getting two goals on the board.
And Josh Lusby, who had two goals up at Oceanside, really has been the Sun Devil killer at the end of this season in the most important games. Josh Lusby in his final game as a Wildcat. Bovolsik with the big hugs from everybody. You love to see it. This is why we support this program. And this is such a fantastic way to end the season on home ice as your Arizona Wildcats beat the ASU Sun Devils 6-4. Two goals from Josh Lusby. And just a fantastic overall evening of hockey here in Tucson.
Yeah, definitely. I want to give a shout out to Ty Marchant for playing a really great game. I don't think he made almost any mistakes this game. Was really pushing ASU through the neutral zone. As a defensive player, I used to play defense, and watching him play was really, really cool.
So as the Wildcats all kind of say goodbye to one another, Chad Berman probably telling the team what they mean to him, what they all mean to each other. Duke Litwin will lead off the handshake line. These two teams, there are multiple guys on each roster that have been playing against each other for years, and this is the final time they'll face off. So we would like to give a big thank you to our graduating seniors, Chris Hedgeco, Cameron Timor, Matthew Hole, Josh Lusby, Duke Litwin, and Nolan Bovolsik. It has been an absolute pleasure being able to call these games over the course of the season. It's been a pleasure getting to know these guys, this team, and it's been a pleasure to have everyone on the live stream with us throughout the season. We will be broadcasting the alumni game, but for everyone who's shown their support this season, we give you all of our thanks from everyone here at the Wildcat media team and the Wildcat hockey program. Sebastian Janik with Garrett Kane, that'll do it for Saturday night. Wildcats sweep the home weekend series. We will be back for the Coyotes alumni game. If we don't see you now, we'll see you next season. Take it easy. This is Wildcat Hockey.